Welcome to Miami. As the clock runs out on 2014, Georgia Tech and Mississippi State will give us one final college football memory. For decades, South Florida has helped ring in the new year with memorable moments.
In triple overtime, Penn State winner.
This is for the national championship for Nebraska. Incomplete.
Intercepted, and the figures may be number one for Colorado.
Tonight, the legacy grows. Few predicted Georgia Tech would be playing in a New Year's Six Bowl. A late season surge and a dramatic victory of their arch rival vaulted the Yellow Jackets onto this prime time stage. From SEC afterthought to number one in the polls, Mississippi State soared in 2014.
This is what he does better than anybody in the SEC.
Now behind their dynamic leader, Dak Prescott, the Bulldogs look to stamp this season as the greatest in school history. The Capital One Orange Bowl, the exclamation point on the first night of college football's brand new tradition, the New Year's Six. You are looking live at Sun Life Stadium in Miami Gardens, Florida. It's prime time for the Capital One Orange Bowl. Mississippi State of the SEC against Georgia Tech of the ACC. As the clock starts to tick the final minutes away toward 2015. Good evening, everybody, and welcome with Jesse Palmer and Maria Taylor. I'm Brent Musburger. Thanks for dropping by. Georgia Tech. I got to tell you, a November to remember, and here they are in the Orange Bowl.
Brent, I think there's a lot of people out there that haven't really watched them play, and they feel like they're a gimmicky offense. They had some big moments, lucky breaks late in some big games, and they're lucky to be here, and I could not disagree with that more. They're a legitimate team. They proved a lot of people wrong. They were picked to finish fifth in their division at the start of the year, but big wins against Georgia, Clemson, only lost to Florida State by 2 points in the ACC title game. They're a very good team. Their offense has been record-setting this year. They're leading the ACC, scoring 37 points a game in Paul Johnson's spread option attack. The biggest reason why has been the quarterback play of Justin Thomas. I think he's the best quarterback Paul Johnson has had at Georgia Tech because of his versatility. He does a very good job reading the option, executing it. He's dangerous when he carries the football. He's also a very good passer. Justin Thomas has to have a big game tonight against what is a very big and very physical Mississippi State defense.
The Ramblin' Wreck arriving here. So, Jesse, now we go back to Mississippi State, 5 weeks number one, but a tough finish, lost two of the last three, especially that game to their arch rival, Mississippi. Any chance of a hangover here?
There could be, and we're going to find that out, obviously. This is not the way that they wanted to finish the season. I think that loss against Ole Miss really hurt. Not only was it a rivalry game, but that loss may have kept them out of the college football playoff. Traditionally, we've seen teams lose big games late in the year, limp into the bowl game, and not play well. But any way you paint it, this has been a special year for Mississippi State. You mentioned it, five straight weeks they were number one in the country. They have to finish the season tonight. If they're going to do that, they need great play from their quarterback, Dak Prescott, one of the best dual threat quarterbacks in the country. His arm strength and his running ability will force Georgia Tech to cover the length and width of the field.
The Bulldogs arrive. Bulldogs made news today when their star running back, Josh Robinson, suddenly announced that this is his last game and he'll bolt for the NFL. Maria, what's that all about?
Well, Brent, you know, Josh is known for his personality and shock value, but he definitely surprised coaches when he announced earlier today on Instagram that he'd be entering the NFL draft early. He told me before the game that he wants to provide for his family. He didn't want to risk getting buried in a depth chart next year or having an injury. The reason he chose Instagram, though, he says, is because he wanted to let the fans know, and he's prepared to have a really successful game today, guys.
Meanwhile, Dak Prescott, their fine quarterback, told us yesterday at our meeting he will return to Starkville next season. He will be back as their senior quarterback. The kickoff from Miami is coming up. And now, a look inside Nissan's Heisman House. Welcome you back, and Maria now is with Mississippi State coach Dan Mullen. So let's go back to Maria.
So, Coach, you don't have Jeff Collins, your defensive coordinator, today. You decide play caller. Why is that the best decision for your team?
Well, I think it was the easiest transition. He's already been down on the field, and with substitution purposes, he doesn't. Deshae's got a great future as a coach. He's a bright young coach, up-and-coming coach, and he's got a great opportunity out here tonight to show what he can do.
Well, the last time we saw your team, it was in a loss to your in-state rival. What makes you believe that there won't be a hangover in today's matchup?
I mean, it's New Year's Eve. We're here at the Capital One Orange Bowl, man. This is as big as it gets at the biggest stage in college football. So I'll tell you what, our guys, I don't see any hangover. We're fired up, excited to be here, ready to play.
Well, your quarterback, Dak Prescott, he's been the catalyst for your offense all season long. What do you need to see from him early to have success?
Well, we got to be efficient on offense. You don't get many possessions against Georgia Tech. We got to execute at a very, very high level.
Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
And this has been the Nissan pregame rush as we get ready for the kickoff. Georgia Tech won the toss. They did defer. As you see Paul Johnson, the Tech coach there on the sideline, he's special. We're going to talk a lot about him tonight and this unusual offense that he operates with great efficiency. Now, if you are a Mississippi State fan, there's an unease, and I can understand. You saw what happened to the Rebels, your arch rival. They were smoked. The SEC West is under fire. Did we overrate them all season? LSU couldn't handle Notre Dame. Now Mississippi whipped by TCU. And so now it is up to the Bulldogs here to represent the SEC tonight. South Florida. Line drive fielded by Holloway, who made like the third baseman at the hot corner. And they will come out on the 25-yard line. And Jesse, we're going to take a close look at the junior from hot Louisiana, Dak Prescott.
One of the best dual threat quarterbacks in the country, 14-5 as a starter. He started in and won some very big games. And there's a multitude of ways that he can stress your defense, both throwing and running the football. He's outstanding on the critical down and distances. Third down and in the red zone, and he's looking for a big night tonight.
Behind him, long side now, left side, Josh Robinson, his last game as a Bulldog. The two-pronged great running attack of the Bulldogs. Robinson, game's first carry. Nothing doing, jumped.
The biggest key for Mississippi State on offense in this game is establishing the inside run game between the tackles. Whether it's Josh Robinson or Dak Prescott, everything they do starts and ends there. That keeps third downs manageable, and it sets up their play action game.
Ted Roof upstairs calling the defensive plays here for Georgia Tech. First pass is complete. That's to Jamion Lewis, and he's out of bounds, but it becomes third and manageable with that completed pass.
Talked about Dak Prescott being one of the best quarterbacks on third down in the nation. This is where his legs can hurt you. If things aren't open downfield, he's out tucking the football and running.
It becomes 11 on 11 when the quarterback runs. Roof's concerned. Instead, high and intercepted. Georgia Tech picks off the deflected pass. They'll have the ball at the 36. Chris Milton, and good things happen to Georgia Tech. They have had an abundance of interceptions. That's the 18th of the season.
It looked like Dak Prescott was trying to throw the slant to the inside to Jamion Lewis, number four. It's tremendous coverage on the play. Ball gets popped up in the air, and there's Chris Milton at cornerback making a diving stop. Georgia Tech steals a possession early, and that's something they've done so well at all season long.
St. John Days will open as the B-back. Justin Thomas is your quarterback, and they're going to run the toss, and Mississippi State jumped Perkins, and that was Calhoun coming up on that corner spot. And Jesse, that was aggressive by the Bulldogs.
It's extremely critical that your perimeter defenders are physical and can take on blocks and make stops. That time, Tevez Calhoun, tremendous speed, shooting into the backfield, creating a loss.
Second and 14. Thomas with that late pitch coming the other way, and that's Perkins. Breaks for a first down across the 20-yard line. Evans, a safety, up for the stop.
I just talked about the pitch man, the perimeter, having to be physical and get off blocks. Take a look up at the right side of your screen right here. There's the key block. He's not able to fight off atop it. And it's an explosive run for Georgia Tech.
23-yard gain. Georgia Tech scored on its first possession against Florida State. Lost by 2 points in the ACC championship game. Coming back, and again, it is that toss outside. Hill this time, and Hill's across the 5-yard line. He is hit by Evans, and all of a sudden, Mississippi State is reeling. A turnover, and here comes Georgia Tech.
Talk about how you have to play good assignment defense. Someone's got to take the pitch. Someone's got to take the quarterback, and someone's got to take the dive. And so far in these last two plays, Mississippi State has not had an answer on defense on the perimeter. And that's led to two explosive runs back to back.
Days is your B-back. He was the go-to guy against the Seminoles. Again, touchdown, Georgia Tech. Sinjin Days, the fifth-year senior from Marietta, Georgia.
What an impressive start to the game by Georgia Tech. You create a turnover on Mississippi State's first possession. You march the football down the field. And you run behind your All-American right guard, Shaquille Mason. Good power running by Sinjin Days. That could not have been a better start if you're Georgia Tech.
This is a Big Ten officiating crew. Let me set that scene right away. Dan Capron, a lawyer from Chicago, is our referee. His umpire is Steve Woods.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Touchdown.
The confirmation came from a long-time outstanding referee upstairs, Jim Kimmerling. Harrison Butker, sophomore from Decatur, Georgia. Tacks on the extra point. And the touchdown underdog, Georgia Tech, strikes first. Great field position following this interception on the deflection. Milton. Now the touchdown. Days. And Mississippi State is dazed. And it's spelled differently. The Rebels turned it over. TCU struck first. Mississippi State turns it over. Georgia Tech strikes first. Like I said, good things happen. When you take a look at the Georgia Tech wins, 16 of their 17 interceptions, Harrison and only one in their three losses. Clemson, two of those interceptions returned for touchdowns and better than 130 yards with those returns.
And Brett, I think what's even more impressive is how they make takeaways count. They've had 28 turnovers on the season. 20 times now they've converted those turnovers into touchdowns. This defense is opportunistic, and they thrive on stealing possessions.
Holloway coming out. Out around the 20-yard line. Dak Prescott and the offense will go back to work. The man who made the interception on the deflection. Prescott has good time, stands and throws to Brown, Fred Brown, with the first reception. Second down and four, and from the gun, Prescott fires a bullet for a first down out to the 38-yard line, and Malcolm Johnson.
There's an example of the arm talent that Dak Prescott has. There was a small window to throw into over the middle of the field to his athletic tight end, Malcolm Johnson. He put it right on his jersey. He had no chance. He had no choice. Had to catch that football. First down, Bulldog.
Shaken up, goes to the sideline. Back, there's a penalty flag, our first flag of the game. Josh Robinson, the ball carrier.
Holding, offense, number 63, 10-yard penalty, first down.
That is Dylan Day, and he's a tough hombre down there in the middle of Coach Mullen's offensive line.
He's right in the middle of the screen there, 63. He's going to get the hold penalty. Now, the physicality of Georgia Tech's front seven is going to be tested. They are very undersized. In fact, up front, they're giving up on average 48 pounds per player to Mississippi State's O-lineman.
That was a takedown. First down and 20 after the penalty. On the slant, deflected, incomplete. Excellent coverage that time by DJ White, one of the team ringleaders. Bright young man, grew up in the shadow of downtown Atlanta. Ask him who should coach the Falcons, who should take over. That's what he said. Rex Ryan. Rex Ryan, I said, why? He said, I like his swagger. Here's second down at 20 now. Another completion to the 40-yard line, and Fred Ross, they're spreading the ball around to different receivers here.
Looks like the game plan, Brett, coming out has been to throw the football. We've got a different formations, trying to get Dak Prescott on the move a little bit. You've seen him in the pocket. We've seen him outside. Here's where Georgia Tech's pass rush has to show up. They're not a team that likes to blitz a lot. They must be able to get pressure on Prescott.
Can he convert a third and nine? Backfield is empty. Offensive line's been giving him time. Again, but it's going to be short of that first down. There's another penalty flag. It was thrown from that far side. Wally, the target that time.
Good job disguising that time by Georgia Tech. It looked like they were going to blitz. They actually ended up dropping eight into coverage, trying to force small windows for Dak Prescott to throw into. There was good coverage, it looked like, from Jamal Golden.
There are two fouls again on the play, both against the defense. Pass interference, defense. Personal foul, roughing the passer. Number 40, defense. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
That is Paul Davis who roughed the passer, and Paul Davis is one of the better athletes on this Georgia Tech defense.
Hey, he's a little guy, 5'11", 218 pounds, but he has tremendous speed. He's one of the guys rushing in, just a hit in late. on the quarterback, Dak Prescott, after he delivers the football. That sets up a huge first down now for Mississippi State into Georgia Tech territory.
I think the fact that he hit him down low.
There's a strike zone, you're right. It's got to be above the knee.
Brought the flag that time as Prescott keeps it to the 35-yard line. Bulldogs trying to answer to that early touchdown.
Mississippi State on offense likes to use tempo. They don't huddle a lot. They move guys around in different spots and try and give the defense different pictures to look at each and every snap.
Prescott keeps it on the option, and it was read perfectly by Paul Davis.
Yeah. P.J. Davis just has tremendous makeups. He does a great job using his eyes and reading his keys and staying home. You know, tackling a 6'2", 230-pound quarterback certainly is not easy. Now he's setting up another big third down. We saw Georgia Tech give them a jump look the last time. This time looking a little bit more vanilla.
Quarterback draw all the way. Prescott busts a tackle, but not Isaiah Johnson, the hard-hitting safety. He is out of Tyrone, Georgia, and he brought the lumber that time.
He plays downhill, Brent. He's a guy that likes to get involved in the run game, and you mentioned it. You can lay the hat on somebody. It's at the top of your screen, number one. It gets out of a back pedal quickly, puts a huge hit on a 230-pound quarterback, and this is kind of that no-man's land for Mississippi State. They're going to go for it on fourth down.
And Shumpert checks in. He's off to the left. Robinson fires, deflected again, incomplete, and it's Georgia Tech football.
I don't know if that ball was deflected, Brent. I think Dak Prescott just missed. Had an opportunity to put this out in front of Jamion Lewis. It was behind him. It's the second time Lewis wasn't able to handle a tough throw over the middle of the field. Georgia Tech ball.
Yep, it was Lewis himself who deflected it incomplete.
The 2014 Capital One Orange Bowl is brought to you by the Quicksilver Card from Capital One. Earn unlimited 1.5% cash back every purchase, every day. The all-new Ford F-150, the future of tough. Allstate, proud supporters of college football. Are you in good hands? And Chick-fil-A, we didn't invent the chicken, just the chicken sandwich.
And Jesse, with Georgia Tech, second possession coming up. Here are Chick-fil-A impact players.
Yeah, Mississippi State's Preston Smith and Bernard McKinney are two all-conference caliber players that are going to have big roles to fill, stopping both the dive and the quarterback in the option game. St. John Days, meanwhile, for Georgia Tech, we've already seen score a touchdown running behind his All-American right guard, Shaquille Mason.
Justin Thomas, the redshirt sophomore out of Alabama, under center. And work in the middle with that dive play, and Sinjin Days, who scored the game's first touchdown.
Well, Bedarvin McKinney, we just talked about at middle linebacker. He's an All-American at 6'5", 250, and a big part of his game tonight is going to be stopping the dive. And in order to do that, he's going to be taking on blocks right in front of him from centers and guards. He's got to be extremely physical. He's very athletic at 6'5", 250 pounds with tremendous speed. He's got a big job, maybe the most important job on Mississippi State's D tonight.
Second down and seven, and here is Thomas. Good deep bomb, throws incomplete. Second and seven, and as Coach Paul Johnson told us, when we throw the football, we mean it. We don't dink and dunk.
They had a big opportunity that was missed. They're going to fake the option, and Darren Waller at 6'5" runs right by the safety, Jay Hughes. Looks like he geared down and slowed down just a little bit trying to locate the football. But you're right, Brent. This is a big-time shot play pass offense. They average 18 yards of completion, which is second most in the country.
DeAndre Smelter out with an injury. He would have been that deep target had he been healthy here tonight. Now they run the option sweep around with Deion Hill, the ball carrier. And it is suddenly fourth down, and number 50 did the job that time. Yeah, Jesse talked about McKinney.
There's a reason why people project him as a first-round pick. If, in fact, he comes out early this year, you cannot coach McKinney's type of athleticism. He's so fast. got a 39-inch vertical, plays with tremendous energy. He's the heart and soul of this defense.
Ross back deep to field this punt by Ryan Rodwell. Off the side of his foot, not a good punt. The Bulldogs will have good field position. So it's New Year's Eve here in South Florida, South Beach, getting ready to celebrate. Some folks, though, inside, watching the monitors of the Capital One Orange Bowl. Welcome back to the Capital One Orange Bowl. 7-0, Georgia Tech with the lead, but 21-yard punt gives Mississippi State good field position. And when you consider the numbers that they put up this year and where they ranked in the SEC, we do expect them to climb back down here and score a few points before this is over.
Well, in games they've had a lot of success, Brent, is when they've had success running the football. And at some point in this game, hopefully sooner rather than later for Mississippi State, that offensive line starts to demonstrate itself.
Play action for Shumpert. Going to take a shot. Had a man wide open, and it is incomplete. And that was Joe Morrow. That would have been a touchdown.
Yeah, there was a coverage bust on the back end from Georgia Tech. Mississippi State continues to be aggressive. Play action on first down. They've got a wide open Morrow on the post. And that's a throw that Dak Prescott simply has to make. You see Milton covering him. He ends up falling off the route.
And live action on your right. That was Fred Ross coming around. And so again, Jesse, this Ted Roof coach defense of Georgia Tech, they forced a turnover. They stopped him at the other end of the field on fourth down. Now they've got him back in third and long. And there is the defensive coordinator with the glasses looking down on the field here. Prescott getting time, and no, down he goes at the 35. Roderick Chungon comes in. He's got a start here tonight for the Ramblin' Wreck, and he makes the most of it.
Well, Brent, I think that was another missed opportunity by Mississippi State. It looked to me watching that live, they had Robert Johnson outside at wide receiver, one-on-one, running free down the sideline. That's a throw. It's a double move that Dak Prescott should have taken a chance on. But you've got to give Georgia Tech's defense credit now. They haven't had to stop a lot of running plays, but they've been so good covering on the perimeter of the field. And on critical third downs, they've been good up front as well with pressure.
Devin Bell punts it away. Golden is back deep. Signals for the fair catch for Georgia Tech and makes the catch back around the 10-yard line, 11 to 12. Good start for Georgia Tech of the ACC in the Capital One Orange Bowl. Aerial coverage provided by Goodyear. Whether you're going for it from a few yards out or from miles away, go with a tire with superior performance. Goodyear, more driven. Jesse, you know what football men say. 1 week to prepare for Georgia Tech, you're in trouble. Give yourself 3 weeks in a bowl game, and you can shut him down. Yeah, the numbers indicate that.
Yeah, you're right. Traditionally, we've seen when good defenses have more time to prepare for Paul Johnson in bowl games, they play better. The issue is, in practice, even if you have more time, you can't simulate the cut blocks, you can't risk injury to your own guys, and your scout team doesn't give you a good enough look.
And here they come, trying to get the edge again with Bostic. Zach Lasky, they had replaced Days as the B-back this time. Two outstanding veteran B-backs. Sinjin Days from Marietta, and Zach Lasky from Peachtree City, Georgia. The Lasky family actually grew up in the Pittsburgh area. The boys' children did. And he's another outstanding young man. It's one thing you could say about Georgia Tech. This is an academic institution. These youngsters have to finish calculus by the end of their sophomore year. Jesse, that's what you did down to Florida.
Yeah, sophomore year of high school. I think that counted as my university credit.
Second down and five. And upended is Justin Thomas by Redmond.
You know, it's interesting. Right now, Mississippi State has a lot of their backups in the game. And throughout the course of the year, this defense has allowed the most explosive plays when the backups are in. That sounds like conventional wisdom. That normally happens. But Mississippi State rotates a lot of different guys. They have co-starters. They call them 1As and 1Bs. The 1Bs are on the field right now. It's important. They play well and don't give up the big plays. You see the new play caller, Deshae Townsend, looking on.
You're a fine player with the Pittsburgh Steelers. Oh, a couple of Super Bowl rings. Played for better than a decade, and this time it's Lasky. He's the B-back pounding across for that first down. It is so difficult for defensive play callers when you work against Johnson's offense. Just what you've been saying here tonight, Jesse.
Well, it's just unique, and it's something that you don't get an opportunity to see throughout the course of the year. And in fairness for Paul Johnson, he has no idea how Mississippi State's going to play him because he hasn't had a chance to watch them on film play his type of offense. So it's a good chess match going on between these two guys.
Reverse action that time, and then a late pitch, and nothing much doing. Deion Hill, they ate him up on that far side. You know, I want to go back to the week turnaround. Well, let's take a Florida State. They won the ACC championship by 2 points. One of the difficulties for Jimbo Fisher or any coach, you can't get your scout team ready. It takes about a week to get them up to speed on running this
offense. Brent, I think a lot of teams come into games against Paul Johnson feeling like they've got a pretty good plan on paper. But when you see the speed at which the pros do it, the experts, Georgia Tech, I think oftentimes defenses get shell-shocked because it just runs so much more efficiently than when they prepare.
Quarterback keeps it, late pitch. Out to the outside, and Perkins, his first carry of the game. And that time Thomas tried to draw the edge defenders in as much as he could before he pitched out.
And Georgia Tech really trying to attack the perimeter of the field, but I'm impressed with the backups at Mississippi State and how they played their assignments. Now, all year long, Georgia Tech was the best third down offense in the entire country. Big down right here.
Paul Johnson calls all the plays, and look, no play chart. That's right. Calls him off the top of his head. Plays the game two or three times the night before. When Thomas, receivers covered, scrambles, great runner, got it. 100-meter champion in the state of Alabama, folks. When he gets daylight, he's dangerous.
This was a quarterback run all the way. They made it design and look like it was going to be a pass. They set up, puts his foot in the ground. He's got linemen blocking downfield. Justin Thomas committed to Alabama out of high school to be a defensive back. Changed his mind as he knew he wanted to play quarterback. And you see the athleticism right there. He is a special player.
The fastest player in Georgia Tech, Broderick Snoddy, an A-back, out with an injury. He's not playing here tonight either, so losses of Smelter and Snoddy. Big and under enormous fire that time. Thomas was surrounded, and A.J. Jefferson in on that defense for Mississippi State.
And A.J. Jefferson is a pass rush specialist. He does a good job here splitting a double team. It's going to be coming up this side right here. Just gets inside. Able to get the hit on Thomas. The ball gets on the ground, and Georgia Tech very fortunate to jump on that. It was their left tackle, Brian Chamberlain, falling on the fumble.
Second down and 13. Thomas again keeping it. And the defender made a move, and Thomas burned him.
What you call a counter option. It's a little wrinkle by Paul Johnson. The play begins looking like triple option. They get the A-back in motion. You see him coming from your right. At the very last second, it's Deion Hill, 31, downfield blocking. Mississippi State in position here to make the play. They've got good flow and speed outside. Just missed tackle right there. And again, the speed of Justin Thomas makes this spread option offense unique. He's their team's leading rusher, and we can see why.
Six first downs already for Georgia Tech. When we throw it, we mean it. Touchdown, Georgia Tech. Darren Waller. You saw the flag in the end zone. Receiver made the catch anyway.
talked about when backups are in the game, that's generally when Mississippi State gives up the biggest plays. There's one right there.
Pass interference. Defense, number 5. The penalty is declined. Touchdown.
And this is a great job play calling by Paul Johnson, because it looked like the exact same play the play before. The counter option run look. You got a big wide receiver in Waller. It's 6'5", 240 pounds, one-on-one. They had a wide open receiver in the slot running down the field. Justin Thomas had his choice. Right now, Paul Johnson, the spread option attack, giving Mississippi State headaches.
Jamerson Love clinging to that jersey. And folks, throughout Mississippi, you got reason to be uneasy. This offense is the real deal. And as I said to Paul Johnson, Paul, why don't other schools run this ball? And he said, I have no idea.
Well, let's go ahead and take a look at this again. This is going to look like counter option, as if, you know, they're coming out here to run, but they've got a slot receiver running right down the middle wide open. This is Waller outside, who's just going to win one-on-one. You had two choices on this throw. You take a look. You see the fast flow by the white jerseys running outside to stop the play. There's two dudes wide open.
Two receivers open, Jesse.
And I like the choice. You know, why not? You got a guy that's 6'5", 250 pounds against a corner that's only 5'10". Take your shot. And there's the payoff.
Three possessions for Paul Johnson's Georgia Tech offense and two touchdowns. Taking a knee is Holloway. Checking down below, and Maria, things are not going well for Mississippi State.
That's right, especially on offense. Brent and Dan Mullen really trying to keep it light right now with his quarterback, Dak Prescott. He grabbed Dak on the sideline and said, are you tight, man? I saw you overthrow Morrow. He said, take your time, get some air under it, and continue to have fun. He's really worried that his quarterback is really wound up right now, guys.
Well, Maria, he's been off a little bit early. We saw him throw a ball behind Jamie and Lewis early on a critical third down. He's missed a couple big shots downfield.
Josh Robinson back on the field after fumble. Georgia Tech pounces on it, or was it blown dead? The official indicates it was blown down. So hang on now. That is Golden, who has the football.
The ruling on the field is that the runner's progress was stopped. Second
There's the
down.
Announcement to the crowd that the runner's progress was stopped by the whistle. Listen for the whistle.
Today.
You know, I thought it came after that.
Yeah, me too. That is a
huge,
yeah. Well, if that's the case, that is a huge break for Mississippi State. You can hear it now, the boos from the Georgia Tech crowd. They feel like that should have been their second turnover. When we heard that, listen for the whistle, that ball came out before I heard anything.
And that was Wilson, incidentally, on that last play. And so here comes third and short, and Zach quickly throws for it to Robert Johnson. So that's a first down.
Let's go back and take another listen to that again, Brent. Live time on that fumble. The handoff to Robinson. Listen when you hear the whistle. That's not even close. That's way after.
Here comes Robinson. Breaks daylight. And into Georgia Tech territory. So, can they take advantage of what appears to be an officiating error? I say appears because we don't know the full details. I'm rather surprised that instant replay didn't shut it down and have at least a conference with the referee down on the field. First down and 10. Dropped. Dropped by Lewis.
Dak Prescott took a big shot. Jamie and Lewis, they just haven't been able to get him going. He's their most dynamic playmaker on the perimeter of the field. I think they need to get back to running the ball, Brent. We saw them with that big explosive play to Josh Robinson two plays ago. This offense needs to get into a rhythm.
We get an explanation from our referee who's up here with us. Sean Smith said that forward progress stopped it. And so the whistle was irrelevant that we heard. So we'll give him that bailout. At the end of first, Georgia Tech with a couple of scores against Mississippi State. Happy New Year, Sean. Big Ten referee Dan Capron explaining to Coach Paul Johnson what Sean Smith relayed to us up here in the booth, and we passed along too. You know, I mentioned that it was a November to remember. Georgia Tech, what a great month they had. And after we watch this second and 10, I'm going to review it. Let's see what happens here. Prescott stands tall. Doesn't get the first down with Wilson. They're going to be a little bit short. Georgia Tech roared past Virginia and North Carolina State 91-33. They held Clemson to two field goals and won 28-6. They traveled to Athens and shocked Georgia 30-24. And then they came within 3 points of upsetting Florida State. Now they face a third and one. Prescott has to battle for it. Picks it up across the 30-yard line. Now on the other side of the coin, it's a November to forget for Mississippi State. They traveled number one to Tuscaloosa and lost to Alabama by 5. And then they lost the Egg Bowl at Oxford to Ole Miss. Play action. Throw that screen out here to Fred Ross, and Ross close to another first down.
But to your point, Brent, I think there's a lot of motivation for Georgia Tech in this game. Their goal at the start of the year was to play in the Orange Bowl. Now, granted, they thought they would have had to win their conference to get here, but you know, they heard all the naysayers say, you know, option offense to disadvantage bowl season, 1-5 under Paul Johnson. You want to prove those naysayers wrong.
Now, Mississippi State starting to move the ball effectively behind the bigger offensive line.
They got to do that, Brent. They got to be dominant up front. They got to rely on these big bodies to establish the line of scrimmage, get some push, because that's where their offense starts and ends.
Play action. Incomplete, and he had Robinson wide open that time, and he simply overthrew him.
He's just off. He's just been missing throws that he's normally able to make. His feet right now look a little bit jittery. I think he's made good decisions for the most part. I think he knows where he wants to go with the ball. He's gone through his progressions. He just has not been accurate enough early in this game. He just has to calm down.
Robinson, nothing doing, and here comes your third down for Mississippi State.
And again, this is an area where Dak Prescott's been so dangerous all year. 17 touchdowns on third down. It's the most of any player in college football, and if nothing's open downfield, this is where he can tuck the football and run. His legs must be a factor in this area of the field.
Going to throw high, incomplete. The defender, DJ White, he wanted offensive interference on that play. He said the receiver was ramming me right there in the Orange Bowl lapel.
I am so impressed with Georgia Tech and how well their perimeter players on defensive play. You talk about Bear Wilson, he's got a 6-inch height advantage over White. Does a great job reading the eyes. Bear Wilson's hand goes up, so does White. Deflects the football, big time play.
Evan Sobieski slides one through that left upright 32-yard field goal. Bulldogs on the board here. 12:57 left in the first half. Capital One, Orange Bowl. Michigan State is on high alert after watching TCU. Bryce Petty will lead that explosive Baylor Bear offense against Connor Cook and the Spartans in the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. and air raid. New Year's Day, 12:30 Eastern. Jesse, let's go back to this.
Yeah, well, you take another look, and it looked like right off the snap, DJ White had grabbed the arm of Bear Wilson. Watch this again. Just going to grab his left arm here off the top, kind of gets a couple arms wrapped around his leg. It was good coverage on the back end, and Dan Mullen had some choice words for the referees here in the commercial break. We've seen his intensity level go way up, down 14-3 here early.
Logan Cook will kick it away from Mississippi State. Jamal Golden back deep. Golden's going to let this one go out of bounds. There'll be a penalty against Mississippi State.
Free kick out of bounds by the kicking team. The ball will be placed at the 35-yard line. First down.
Just haven't looked sharp really in any aspect of the game so far. Offensively, they've had a turnover, almost had a second. They've missed some big plays in the passing game. Defensively, they've given up explosive plays. Now you kick the football out of bounds and give Georgia Tech tremendous field position.
Mississippi State with a possible hangover, and it's not even New Year's morning. Zulaski, they should be back for the Ramblin' Wreck. Justin Thomas. Thrown for a touchdown already, comes in underneath, complete, and works the Waller. That's his go-to target. 6'5", he's without 6'3", DeAndre Smelter.
This is a nice job by Waller, coming back to the quarterback and working himself open. Play action on first down. Look at the right side of your screen. Watch him come down the stem and work himself towards the sideline, away from the defender, giving a 5'11" quarterback and Justin Thomas an open target, a place to go with the football.
Second down and three. There's the toss play to Perkins coming around and cannot get the left side. Redmond tackles him for a loss. That's a fine young defensive back. He's out of Memphis. Will Redmond went to East High School.
Well, Redmond made the tackle, but it was linebacker Matt Wells, 22, up top here that makes the play. You're going to see Speedy gets off the block, gets outside, isn't able to make the stop, but it forced the ball carrier to slow down. Now setting up third down. Now, in a similar situation, last drive, we saw Justin Thomas drop back to pass and take off running. What do they got dialed up here?
Keeps it on the option, and he was hit by Ryan Brown from New Orleans, Louisiana.
It's a great job in assignment football, understanding where everyone needs to be and making plays. 48 right here. He's going to wait outside. And take the quarterback, Justin Thomas, that's running right at him. You've got a linebacker inside of McKinney. He's taking away the dive. 48 stays home. Finally, good assignment defense all the way across the board by Mississippi State. Sets up a very rare occasion for Georgia Tech, but they don't punt the football very often.
Rodwell lost back deep for the Bulldogs. Takes it on the run. Good gamble on his part. To the 45. Good striking position for Mississippi State. It's a gorgeous night here in the Miami area for our Capital One Orange Bowl. Great sight, isn't it? One of the great cities in North America.
The 2014 Capital One Orange Bowl is brought to you by Taco Bell, bringing you the first ever student section at the College Football Playoff. Live Mas, AT&T, presenting sponsor of the College Football Playoff National Championship Game. Cadillac and Gatorade. Gatorade knows it all begins within. Win from within.
Georgia Tech leading Mississippi State 14-3 with 11 minutes left here in the second quarter. You see Mississippi State. They're on the sidelines. Their offense takes over. Dak Prescott was eighth in the Heisman Trophy voting. He was the leader in midseason when the Bulldogs were number one. And good play action. throwing, complete, and out of bounds at the 25-yard line that time. And that's Joe Morrow again, the junior from Ocean Springs, Mississippi.
Their passing game is dependent on play action. They do a really good job making it look like run. It's a good ball fake by Dak Prescott, good patience, allowing Joe Morrow to come across the formation for a big catch downfield.
Yeah, 32 yards, Jesse, as Ashton Shumpert is back in. He's been rotating with Robinson. Play action again, and now Dak Prescott finding Morrow as his go-to guy.
Another example of how they make play action look like run. It's not just the ball fake, but it's pulling offensive linemen this way. It's making linebackers run downhill and freeze for just a moment. It makes the windows bigger for Dak Prescott.
Flinging it again to Morrow. Three consecutive times going to work on the left side of the Georgia Tech defense as they move down the field.
Play action on first down has been big on this drive. It's been big all season long. They had 57 plays of 20 yards or more on first down, second most in the country. Big reason why, play action.
Clausell, Malone, Dave, Beckwith, and Senior of your offensive line. They have been giving Prescott time, and he's going to run behind the line for the touchdown. Dak Prescott carries it over, and Mississippi State is back in the thick of things. There's nothing like pay dirt, Jesse.
No, there's not, Brent.
This is the 14th touchdown that he has scored this year rushing. If you take away the sacks, he's a 1,000-yard rusher this year. They have changed that rule anyway. Do it like the big fellas in the NFL. Brent, Jesse, and Maria at the Capital One Orange Bowl, and Jesse, DirecTV takes us inside that scoring drive.
Yeah, Dan Mullen is an offensive play caller going to play action and doing it on first down, trying to wake up this offense. It's a nice play fake to Shumpert. You roll out to the left. It gives skinny jeans Joe Morrow a chance to cross the formation. There's an accurate throw by Prescott. Very next snap, you pull line and you make it look like run. Prescott gets through the progression. Easy throw to the sidelines. That sets up a big run for their big quarterback. They got a great block downfield by Dillon Day. Play action's gotten Dak Prescott into a rhythm, and as a result, this offense has finally woken up. You see there, Brent, 57% of Dak Prescott's pass attempts this year have come off of play action. That's the third most of any Power 5 quarterback.
Logan Cook kicks it away from Mississippi State. Golden. Bounce past him and on into the end zone as a touchback. Well, of course, the college football playoff kicks off on New Year's Day. Back-to-back semifinal games. Oregon battles Florida State at 5 Eastern in the granddaddy of them all. The Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual. Then at 8:30 Eastern, number 1 Alabama takes on number 4 Ohio State. The All-State Sugar Bowl. All on ESPN. What a week of football viewing, Laddie.
Must watch television, Brent. Get near a television set or get near a couple and go ahead and enjoy that one.
I'm going to be there for Baylor, Michigan State.
Very nice.
Days is back in as your be back here, Ramblin' Wreck. And nothing doing against the middle of that Mississippi State line. Preston Smith, who's had a fabulous year, number 91, folks.
Step one of stopping the option is stopping the dive play. That's the first phase. And if you don't stop it, you're going to die a very slow death, as many teams have found out since Paul Johnson took over at Georgia Tech. Now, as a defense, sometimes it's going to be the defensive end like Preston Smith. Other times, it'll be a linebacker. You've got to mix up the ways you do that. But so far tonight, the Bulldogs haven't allowed a lot of yards up the middle.
Thomas on the quick pitch. outside, and that's third and manageable. Quick throw to Summers, and that was Paul Johnson noticing that the coverage was soft, and he simply whistled up that throw to the receiver and took what they gave him.
Nice play call. As a defense, though, you're under pressure. You got to force Georgia Tech into fourth and long, because if they get into fourth and short, they're going to go for it. So there's pressure to put three good plays back to back to back if you're Mississippi State, forcing three and outs, because that's something Georgia Tech only had nine of this year coming into tonight, the fewest in the country.
Third and three. Thomas moving the pocket to the right. Going to throw, got a man open. He's got his target. Darren Waller from Ackworth, Georgia. Went to North Cobb High School. He's a senior, and that's 38 more yards. And, folks, he was wide open.
Well, there's another bust. They roll out Justin Thomas to the right. Cornerback completely crashed on it, and that put Waller at 6'5", behind a safety. And that's just way too easy. Another explosive play in the passing game.
First down and 10. The option look. Thomas cut off, trying to come back with that speed of his. And he is finally stopped, and Smith and Jefferson surrounding him. Two of those big rascals.
They are a big physical front seven, Brent. You're on the field pregame. It looks like an NFL front seven, and they pride themselves in stopping the run. Prove that against physical offensive lines this year, like LSU and Arkansas. They shut Alabama down running the football. They want to play in a phone booth, and what makes them unique is not only are they big and long athletes, these guys can run.
Second down and 14. Play action. Thomas. And he has to basically throw this away, even though he had a target there, so he actually did not throw it away, but he took what he thought he might get, but that's going to leave him with a third down and 14.
So anticipating a pass right here if you're Mississippi State, and I think we've seen here in recent downs, especially from A.J. Jefferson, 47, who's now leaving the field, they've done a pretty good job getting in the back, but you've got to be able to disrupt Justin Thomas's timing. He's only 5'11". He needs windows to throw, dude. You need to try to make a move. You got to keep him in the pocket.
Harrison Butker, one of the heroes of that Georgia win, needs a few more yards here for Georgia Tech to think about the field goal. And in trouble is Thomas. He got thrown this one away to avoid the loss. And it was almost picked off. It was.
Wow.
Beautiful interception by Brown as Justin Thomas makes a mistake.
So their intern play caller, Deshae Townsend, on an obvious passing situation, dials up pressure to try and force Thomas outside. Thomas does the right, has the right idea to throw this away, but he didn't throw it far enough out of bounds. Did he get his foot down after the catch?
He did. Yes,
that is a tremendous effort by Mississippi State, and all of a sudden, all of the momentum has shifted back to the Bulldogs. What a job by Boniquez Brown, making that catch and tap dancing on the sideline.
Down four with the football. Josh Robinson checks in. There's Kimberly wants to take another look at this, and he will see clearly that the left foot is down, and this one will be confirmed as a good call on the field. And you know, Jesse, let's talk about this Mississippi State defense. Under fire early in this game, but they're starting to ratchet up some pressure. They're cutting off the option look with the quarterback. Tell us what you see.
What?
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Interception, first down.
Well, firstly, I think they've done a good job taking away the inside running plays from Georgia Tech. But secondly, they've done a good job setting up third and long in this game. And when they set up obvious passing situations, it's the athletes up front for Mississippi State that I think are affecting Justin Thomas. We know it's not Georgia Tech's game to want to pitch it a lot.
Now let's see what Robinson can do, and nothing doing, battling, and he lost a yard. Davis making the stop again. Very active linebacker, as we pointed out.
We talked about how this front seven is undersized from Georgia Tech, and they had to be physical, but you can see they've got speed too, and they can fly around, they can be disruptive and make plays. It's been tough sledding tonight for the Bulldogs running the ball.
Prescott found yards to his right. He's looking Now he's going to take off, and he's got a first down easily. Slides to the 40, 39-yard line.
I think it's the biggest improvement Dak Prescott made this season from a year ago as a Georgia Tech defender.
Man, we've got an injured. That's Smith. Mont Smith is down, Jesse.
You go back and you see the progression here by Dak Prescott. You know, another year in the offense, understanding his keys and what to look for. Things aren't open downfield. He doesn't panic. Check down, doesn't want it. Just puts his foot in the ground, gets north-south, moves the chains. And losing Smith, if they do lose him, is a big loss for Georgia Tech because he's their starting nickel. You know, they don't play a lot of base defense with three linebackers. He's a guy that's got athleticism to cover receivers in the slot, but he's also really physical. Take a look again. It looks like he might have gotten a knee in the gut, maybe. Left knee from Dak Prescott. Oof. I hate to see that.
Shaken up on the play, and the fine medical staff from Georgia Tech is down on the field. You know, Georgia Tech, I want to take you back. It was about 1990. I was working with my buddy, Dick Vermeil.
Okay.
Bobby Ross was the coach. We were up at the Citrus Bowl in Orlando, and they pound Nebraska.
Okay.
And they win a share of the national championship.
Right.
You know?
Sean Jones was playing
That's the last time that I saw Georgia Tech in a bowl game.
That's the last time you saw them in a bowl game. You know, they've been in a bunch of others since that time.
I haven't done one since.
Well, this is obviously a big one they're in right now. And we know, talking to their players and their coaches, they're excited to be here.
Yes, they are.
You know, they thought, of course, they had to win the ACC to get here. That's really good news, by the way, seeing number 12 Smith walking out the sideline. But you know what, a special year that Georgia Tech has had this season, and as people are finding out right now, Mississippi State's finding out, they're a really good team.
Play action, and now he's got that working. Lewis back out of bounds here on the near side, but that's a first down. But there was a reason why I mentioned Vermeil. He's going into the Rose Bowl Hall of Fame this week. He will be out there for the game between Florida State and Oregon, and it's an honor he much deserves. He had a great Rose Bowl win against Woody Hayes. Here's a handoff now. Robinson cuts back, another first down, and his helmet's ripped off, and there's a penalty flag. That's going to go against White.
Josh Robinson doing a great job with his vision. Play was designed to go inside. Bounced it outside, got downfield. The penalty is going to make this a huge gain for Mississippi State. They continue to roll.
Personal foul, face mask, defense, number 29, 15-yard penalty, first down.
Go back and take a look at this again. You'll see DJ White just kind of getting low. He's got that left arm grabbed right around the face mask, rips the helmet off.
Mississippi State looking for its first lead here, and Shumpert replaces Robinson. Play action to him, under pressure, firing incomplete. So one of the twins, Lance Austin, bringing the pressure. Lance is Lawrence Austin's twin brother on this Georgia Tech team. And Ted Roof, interestingly enough, the defensive coordinator, he has twin boys. They play at Buford High School. Fine young football players there. This is Prescott again, and he muscles his way. Jesse, as you pointed out so many times, and we've covered him, how strong he is.
Yeah, well, that's part of the deal. In this inside power running game between the tackles, it's not just always Josh Robinson and Ashton Shumpert, but you've got basically an additional running back and a 230-pound quarterback in Dak Prescott. And all three of these guys can wear you down. They will put your defense to the test physically. Another big area, third down. Now, we saw them try bear Wilson before. Here he is lined up in the slot. Number one, big tall receiver.
Third and seven. Great time. And he throws it away. Didn't have an open receiver, but the offensive line's giving him time.
Yeah, they sure are. You know, that is a good throwaway for Dak Prescott. Not trying to fit that in there. If you don't think that you're going to have a chance, just put that high and out of the back of the end zone. Points at a premium right now. He did a good job switching the field with field position. Take advantage of that turnover you just got in the interception. Make it pay off. Get points on the board.
Evan Sobiesk, Hattiesburg, Mississippi. He's just a sophomore. He made that 32-yarder, as you remember. Now knocks a 30-yarder right down the middle. Mississippi State pulls to within a point. But Paul Johnson's offense is under fire from Dan Mullen's defense. The aerial coverage provided by Goodyear, whether you're going for it from a few yards out or from miles away. Go with a tire with superior performance. Goodyear, more driven. 14-13, 1-point football game. Georgia Tech led 14-0. Mississippi State. The SEC has responded with 13 unanswered here in the second quarter. We've got 5 minutes of the intermission. More cowbell. They did allow them in this stadium tonight, but they said they want to put down when the opposing center is up under center and ready to go.
Oh, cowbell compliance, Brent.
Golden's down at the 17, Jesse.
Well, Brent, earlier in the game, we saw Mississippi State defensively struggle with the perimeter running game. Recently, though, they've kind of gotten it figured it out now. They're playing assignment football. Here you see defensive tackle take away the dive. You've got a player in position to take the quarterback, one position to take the pitch. The running game hasn't so much been the issue. It's been throwing the football downfield to Darren Waller, who already has 3 catches for 87 yards. That's the next phase right now that Mississippi State is going to have to figure out, slowing down this passing game.
Yeah, Thomas has thrown for only 93, and Waller has 87 of them. First down and 10. And they run the toss play to the right side, and that is Perkins. Just kind of a straight power toss that time, and a very good first down.
Well, it's interesting, you know, they're playing shorthanded, Brent. We talked about injuries. You had mentioned Tony Zenon not playing at A-back. Broderick Snoddy, their fastest player, had a leg injury against Clemson. Another A-back out, and their best receiver, DeAndre Smelter, out with a knee injury against Georgia. So at the skill positions in this game, Georgia Tech, you see right there, 2 key players not in this game. Not at full speed, still getting Mississippi State problems.
Bang for a first down with Days. And Maria, what's going on down below with the Mississippi State defense? Jeff Collins, of course, moved to Florida.
Well, the coaches decided to make a late change to their strategy and move safeties coach Tony Hughes down to the field instead of having him in the press box. The idea there is to have him there for substitutions. He's working with linebackers and the secondary.
And of course, what that does is you lose your eyes up above. First down and 10. And there's the fellas upstairs now trying to replace his point of view. And again, they're coming right back that same side on first down. Jesse, they found something.
Yeah, they did. I think Paul Johnson is so good at making adjustments in game and kind of changing up the looks. And right now, attacking outside again, not with the option, but just with straight sweep plays. They're pulling Shaquille Mason, their All-American guard, getting him outside, more players at the point of attack. And so far on this drive, having more success running the ball.
So now Mississippi State will have to adjust again. First down and 10. The game of chess continues against this option attack. Straight back. And it is complete, and it is Waller again. They're giving him a big cushion, and Georgia Tech taking advantage of it.
Well, I don't blame them for giving him the cushion. They've seen him twice run behind them for big explosive plays, but you see the corner here is going to crash down, expecting to run play. That sets up a one-on-one with a safety, and that's a mismatch. But good route. We've seen them hit that throw twice early. Passing game has been very good for the Yellow Jackets early.
Yeah, they cornered a bit too early on the play action, didn't they? Quick strike outside. You could see how soft that coverage was, right? That's like stealing.
Yeah, but it's a problem when defending this option offense too, Brent, because you have to sacrifice a corner or a safety every play to take a pitch defender, and that's going to automatically set up one-on-one opportunities outside. Paul Johnson has always recruited big receivers. He inherited Bebe Thomas outside, had Stephen Hill, of course, had DeAndre Smelter at the start of the year. He's got a 6'5 guy now. When they've got one-on-ones, you take those shots, and it's tough to defend.
Just missed one by the name of Calvin Johnson. He was with the regime before Paul got there. That time, Mississippi State jumped all over Hill. Now, another good player, Calhoun, among the defenders there.
So here's that third and long situation again. That's interesting. Does Paul Johnson go to a pass play here? Does he feel like in Mississippi State territory he might be in four down territory? Do they run it here, trying to set up fourth and short to run it again?
Andrews, you can see, just checked in off his bench. St. John Days. He's directly behind Justin Thomas. Needs six. Good looking arm. Goes back to Darren Waller for the first out. You know, we talk about Justin Thomas and his ability to run this option. This is a pretty good throwing arm.
Yeah, and he's versatile. He can run and he can throw. You see the touch on this play right here. I think the quarterbacks previously under Paul Johnson, whether it was Sean Nesbitt, Tevin Washington, those guys were better runners. Thad Lee, their most previous quarterback, was a good thrower, but he didn't really execute the option great. That's just a perfect throw over top of Jameson Love. For the completion, you see why Justin Thomas makes this offense so dynamic.
So it's a first down at the 27-yard line. There's that misdirection play, and Thomas with that speed. And now he steps out of bounds, but it's a good gain here on first down.
And it's another wrinkle by Paul Johnson, trying to take advantage of the fast flow defense by Mississippi State. Really good ball handling by Thomas, and you get one of your best athletes out on the perimeter of the field. On this drive, Brent, we've seen a few different wrinkles in the running game that they hadn't shown earlier. And now Mississippi State, they're on their heels a little bit. They're not sure how to adjust.
Second down and five. Days close. Very close.
And it's not just changing up the perimeter runs like we've seen, but it's changing up a simple dive play like that. Normally, Justin Thomas just opens up to the fullback and hands it off. That time, he reverse pivots out. It's a little bit of a different look. It freezes the linebackers just for a second, and they get positive yardage.
So it is third and very close. The dive for the first down, and St. John Days keeps going to about the 13-yard line, and Georgia Tech threatening here with a minute remaining in the first half.
They're going to get the ball back first in the second half, so this would be huge for Georgia Tech to capitalize with a touchdown before time expires here in the half.
Paul Johnson will try to kill the clock one way or the other. Toss coming around and not much doing with Andrews. McKinney back on the field.
There's a timeout by Georgia Tech.
So we've got a timeout down on the field, and right now, Jesse, let's go to your friend John Saunders for an update. Big John, take it away.
Brent, thanks a lot. Thought I was your friend as well, not just Jesse's, the fellow Canadian. Now, coming up on our halftime report, we're going to have a look at the Fiesta Bowl. Quite a finish there. And how about TCU? They made a big statement today. Perhaps they should be in the last four teams. We'll have a look ahead to those last four teams. It's semifinal eve, not just New Year's Eve. Back to my friends out there. Jesse Brent.
Happy New Year, John. And yes, you are my friend. He does a great job. And you two together did a terrific job at the studio. And you got the old coach, Max Brown.
Danny Cannell with him as well over there. You know, there's not many Canadians in the world, but there's only 18 of us, so we got to stick together.
Talking Hawk, Talking Hawk. Second down now and 10, and Lasky steps in. There's that play action. And Thomas with that great speed, end zone, dive pylon, put it on the board.
It is another fantastic job by head coach Paul Johnson adjusting on the fly. We saw this running play a few plays ago with the counter, but that was a designed run. This time they gave Justin Thomas the option to throw the football if anything was downfield. He stretches out, ball touches the pylon before his knee hits. That's a score, and that is a phenomenal answer by Georgia Tech. When all the momentum looked to be going back towards Mississippi State, to get that score late, not just a field goal, a touchdown with less than 30 seconds to go in the half. And again, they're getting the ball first in the second.
So it was a 12-play, 82-yard scoring drive. It took 4:38 off that clock. Drive started back on their own 18-yard line that time. Georgia Tech's going to have a good football team next year. Thomas is back. They've got to replace a few running backs and Smelter, but some way, somehow, he always finds backs and wide receivers in this offense. He's also got some offensive linemen coming back. Chamberlain, Braun, Burden, Joe, although he does lose Shaquille Mason, and Shaquille's a really good one on the right guard.
They got a lot of their best players back on defense as well. I think they're going to play good on that side of the football too. They've got a tough non-conference schedule. They're going to go at Notre Dame. They're going to get Georgia at home. But you know, the scheme, I mean, you could just plug and play. I mean, this spread option attack with Paul Johnson, the scheme generates yardage. And as long as Justin Thomas is under center running it, his offense is going to generate points just like they did this season.
So with only a handful of seconds on the clock, they're expecting a short kick here. Fair catch is the signal at the 29-yard line. Well, Capital One Bowl Mania continues tomorrow. Let's not overlook Auburn taking on Wisconsin. That's another SEC team going to war. That's the Outback Bowl at noon on ESPN2. Then Missouri, the SEC's champion, will battle a surprisingly good Minnesota team in the Buffalo Wild Wings Citrus Bowl. That's 1 Eastern on ABC. So while we talk about the playoffs, don't forget the warm-up games that are coming your way tomorrow. There's big buzz about the SEC. Better believe that. Texas A&M and Arkansas, they collect wins. Georgia got one. But then suddenly, LSU and Ole Miss lose games. First down and 10 now. And a penalty.
Full start. Offense. Number 75. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Big Blaine Clausel out of Mobile, Alabama, a senior.
Well, it looks like with 29 seconds left, Dan Mullen and Mississippi State into attack mode here. They've got all three timeouts in their back pocket. They've got a quarterback that can reach the end zone on Hail Marys with his arm. So they're going to attack and try and take shots.
And here's Prescott firing into the middle. Incomplete. Fred Brown.
Well, Dak Prescott wasn't very accurate early in the game, but as this half has unfolded, he's gotten more and more accurate, and that's a ball that Fred Brown has to catch. Perfectly thrown out in front. Because of that, there's an opportunity for number 5 not just to make the catch, but to get north. It's a missed opportunity. We've seen this offense have a few of those early in this game.
23 seconds. This will be short of the first down. Goes back to Malcolm Johnson. Prescott with 14 receptions. Morrow and Ross with 3 apiece. Wilson, somewhat surprisingly, he's sort of the go-to target, Jesse, but he's only caught a couple passes. It just hasn't been a smooth passing game for Dak.
No, it hasn't. Not so far. And again, we saw them have a deflected throw that was intercepted early in this game. They missed a deep shot early as well to Joe Morrow. They had a guy wide open down the sidelines that Dak Prescott didn't take advantage of. But again, they found their rhythm. The play action passing games got them back in this game. They found some explosive plays. Right now, where they sit on the field at the end of this half, they're probably 10 yards away from really having an opportunity to throw a Hail Mary. And they've got timeouts in their back pocket they can use. They don't need to get out of bounds. They can throw over the middle of the field. They've got a quarterback that can reach it. The guy you just mentioned, Bear Wilson, at 6'6", he's a good target to throw these Hail Marys on.
Third down, and they're going to run for the first down. Robinson picks it up easily, and the clock will stop momentarily, and let's see what Dan wants to do with the final 10 seconds here.
I don't think you have to take the shot right now. I think you still have an opportunity to get a few more yards and burn that final timeout and give yourself that chance.
He's going over things with his junior quarterback.
But again, I watched film, Brent, of number 15, and I've seen him throw the football 70 yards in the air on game day. I mean, this is easily within his range to complete a Hail Mary if this offensive line could give him time for his receivers to get downfield.
Who does he think he is, Doug Flutie? Final 11. Prescott throws a bullet for a first down with 7 seconds. Wilson made that catch, and there is the big target that Jesse spoke. And now, Jesse, you can launch one.
Yeah,
here.
No doubt. So there's two things you really need to prepare for if you're Georgia Tech. You're anticipating the Hail Mary throw. I think you should be anticipating Dak Prescott to try and get outside the pocket and buy himself some time. So as a pass rush, you want to get wide. You want to make sure you keep Dak Prescott inside the pocket. And as a defense on the back end, knock the ball down. How many times in these situations have you seen defenders try and go up and get the interception and get the statistic, and it ends up backfiring right in their face? These are situations that teams practice each and every week, because these opportunities obviously come up in games like it is right now. So Georgia Tech going to get their hands team on the field, bat the ball down on the back end, and as a pass rush up front, you want to get wide out here and keep Dak Prescott inside.
Timeout by Georgia Tech.
Charge timeout, Georgia Tech. Their second 30-second timeout.
Well, Johnson now wants to go over some of the things that you were talking about, Jesse, just alerting the secondary, yeah, what to do back there on the Hail Mary.
I think a part of it too is you kind of want to see how Mississippi State lines up. You want to see where the receivers are, where's Bear Wilson. He's the big target, 6'5". You want to kind of get the alignment down so you can get your defense in the best position possible. Nonetheless, I think it's been an impressive first half for Georgia Tech. Offensively, they've come up with explosive plays. Defensively, big turnover, almost had a second. They made some stops. Got to feel good if you're Paul Johnson. You need one final play here before the halftime.
Here we go. Prescott's got time, and he launches it toward the end zone and targets galore. Dive for a touchdown, Fred Ross. The Hail Mary.
That is exactly how you draw it up if you're Mississippi State. You've got three receivers down the end zone. Look at the trailer. That's Fred Ross, number 8. He's short on purpose because he wants to see if there's a deflection his way.
Instant replay is going to take a look at it.
But that's a catch, Brent. The ball's allowed to touch the ground, and I think he had complete possession.
There's no question. Instant replay is taking a look at this.
Look at that. That's why you leave the trailer short in case the ball deflects towards the goal line.
Fred After
Ross
further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Touchdown.
All over, Jesse. Touchdown, Mississippi State.
And what an answer to Georgia Tech's answer. You've got the stage right now coming out on the field.
Now, the extra point is going to be attempted with a halftime stage, and they got to tell the fellas clear the field, because remember, on a blocked extra point, the defense can score 2 points. So we got a very, very eager grounds crew here, and the fellas have got to get it off to the sideline. You know, the Orange Bowl for decades has been famous for its halftime shows, but that one just a touch.
People just don't believe in Hail Marys and miracles anymore, you know, Brent? This is college football, brother.
You set it up beautifully. You set it up all the way. You said he needed a few more. You were all over that. You know, you got a future in this business.
If I keep working with guys like you, I might stick around.
Make it a 1-point game. Come on back and visit us in the second half. AT&T bringing us inside the headset. So let's head back down to the field with Maria Taylor.
Well, Coach, you get the Hail Mary as time expires. Is that how you drew it up?
We practice it. We tell our guys to practice that every single week. You don't need it until you need it. Today we needed it, and they did a great job executing it perfectly.
What does it mean to convert that play as you go into locker room?
Well, it's huge because they're going to get the ball to start the second half. You don't get many possessions. We've missed two red zone opportunities, had to settle for field goals. Have some drop passes, some penalties. We missed some big plays on the defense side of the ball. But, you know, our guys are going to compete. They're going to play hard. They're going to fight for 60 minutes.
All right, thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Maria. Yogi Berra couldn't have said it any better. You don't need it until you need it. And Mississippi State needed it. Ball game on in South Florida. 41 points, 21-20. The underdog leads it. Get out at those windows in Las Vegas and then get yourself in front of those monitors. We got plenty coming your way. High and intercepted. Touchdown, Georgia Tech. When we throw it, we mean it. Touchdown, Georgia Tech. I mean, he's going to run behind the line for the touchdown. And Thomas with that great speed. End zone. Dive. Put it on the board. Prescott's got time. Dive for a touchdown. We welcome you back to the Capital One Orange Bowl. A one-point game. Dan Mullen and Mississippi State with a Hail Mary at the end of the half. And it is a 21-20 game. And Paul Johnson, the Georgia Tech coach, needs to dial up his offense. His quarterback has been spectacular. And Jesse Palmer, did that Hail Mary, you think, just kind of changed the whole game?
Yeah, I think it did. It's not luck. You heard Dan Mullen tell Marib at the end of the half, this is something they practice, something they plan for when the opportunity arises. There's method to the madness, and this is perfect execution. The whole premise is that you want to layer the end zone with wide receivers, and that's what happens right here. You see, they've got a guy here and a guy here in the middle of the end zone to catch it. If they deflect it behind, there's a receiver up top. If they deflect it in front, there's Fred Brown underneath. Good job of layering the end zone. The deflection bounces right to Fred Ross. It's a phenomenal job making the catch. Executed perfectly. Big play at the end of the half, and that could be a play that ends up determining the outcome of this game.
When you take a look at the numbers from the first half, you can see that Georgia Tech with 134 rushing yards. If they hit 300, they are lethal, but they're not halfway there yet. Passing yards, Mississippi State. Prescott doing it right now. Bell is going to kick this away after some problems with the kickoff. Mississippi State changed it, and this is Golden from the goal line. And Golden is out to the 25-yard line. Let us go down below. Maria Taylor. Maria.
Well, Brent, Paul Johnson said that he did not even address the Hail Mary with this team. He said it's just a play that Mississippi State made to end the half. Now, his biggest concern right now is getting pressure on the quarterback, Dak Prescott. He says he has too much time to operate. He's happy with the way his offense is working right now, being able to put together over 250 yards in the first half, guys.
All right, Maria, as we begin that final countdown towards 2015. Days, he's the B-back set right behind Justin Thomas, the redshirt sophomore who just joined us from Prattville, Alabama, 100-meter champ. He's the signal caller for Georgia Tech, and they run a quick pitch to the right side. That has been successful, Jesse.
Yeah, it has. It's an adjustment that Paul Johnson has gone to. Speaking of adjustments, Paul Johnson is lethal when this football team comes out in the second half. In 9 of 13 games this year, they've scored a touchdown on the first drive of the second half. We've seen Paul Johnson make in-game adjustments successfully throughout this game. He's been on top. He's been giving this offense a chance.
without a play chart, calls all the plays on the sideline for the Ramblin' Wreck. Second down and four. They start that motion the other direction, come back with Days, and there's a huge hole. Midfield. And he batters his way toward the end zone. Goes in for the touchdown. There's no signal that he was out of bounds, folks. There's no flag. How about this 69-yard touchdown run by Sinjin Days?
Well, it was a phenomenal job getting push on the left side of the offensive line, giving Days a crease to run into, and then just poor tackling. Three missed tackles. Calhoun lowers his head.
The under further review.
It doesn't wrap up.
Ruling on the field was a touchdown.
And I think he stayed in bounds. Great job tap dancing, and if this stands up now, that's the 10th time this year. First drive of the second half. They score. Look, runs over a defender. Doesn't look like anything touches the white chalk outside. Didn't have a lot of success with the dive play in the first half, but here early, the offensive line gets push. What an answer by Georgia Tech.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Touchdown.
Hail Mary followed by Hail Joseph. Unbelievable. The last two plays from scrimmage in with one in between.
That's something, Dan Mullen, Mississippi State, they got to get fixed. Again, step one in stopping the option is stopping the dive play. They give up a long explosive touchdown here early in the second half.
And that is a way to respond with how the first half ended. And what a classy way going into the end zone. I can't say enough about Sinjin Days when he hits Pater. Watch this. This is the way to score a touchdown, young man. Some of you big fellas, take a lesson from that. ...28-20. Ramblin' Wreck. Sinjin Days, his second touchdown of this game, 72 yards. Now who does he head for on the sideline? Right up to the coach, whistled up that play. And he's quite a story, this young man. He did not start out as a running back. He was a backup quarterback. In his first 40 games, 561 rush yards, and in the next six, you can see what he's accomplished. And he scored three touchdowns against the Florida State Seminoles. So the Noles who are watching this game as they get ready for Oregon, they can tell you all about this young man right here. Now Georgia Tech has put up 209 rushing yards. Remember I told you Paul Johnson is lethal. 37-10 when a team reaches 300 yards. And they'll take a knee and it'll come back out here. And now it is Mississippi State's. Were they stunned by that, Jess? What's your feeling about the Bulldogs?
Well, I think absolutely. And, you know, I think one issue up front on the defensive line getting pushed back like that, but secondly, just poor tackling on the play.
And we had a flag on this kickoff. Big Ten officiating crew, in case you just joined us. That's Dan Capron on the right, lawyer from Chicago.
There is no foul for illegal formation on the kicking team. First down.
So now Mississippi State offensively has to take the field again, and they're going to have to respond. They really found their rhythm in the second quarter of this game. That now has to carry over here into the third. They've had a lot of success throwing the football. Maria told us when we talked with Paul Johnson, they need to find more pass rush and start affecting Dak Prescott in these passing downs.
In that secondary, there's a big hole. Maria just told us that Isaiah Johnson has headed back to the locker room, and he's a big hitter back there. Golden still at one of the safety spots. First down and 10. Prescott hands to Robinson. Good run here. 43-yard line, and Lance Austin makes the stop.
He's got a really low center of gravity for a 5'9" running back, and he's able to cut quickly. His feet always chopping on the ground, breaking tackles. There's a reason they call him the bowling ball.
That was Robinson again.
And I like the idea, Brent. We talked about them needing to be more physical up front at the line of scrimmage and start running the ball. Now, they threw it a lot in the first half. There are cases sometimes in play callers that the pass actually sets up the run. This offensive line has to keep establishing itself. I like the idea of giving 13 the rock.
Corey Griffin getting some playing time in that secondary, and Robinson slips. He tried to turn the corner. Sean Green making the stop for Georgia Tech, and it is suddenly third down.
This is where you want to see the pass rush now. An obvious passing situation. Getting home. This defensive line, I think, for the most part in the first half, has been physical against the run, but they haven't been getting back to Dak Prescott. They've got to find a way to get pressure on him.
Stands tall and fires the first down pass to Lewis.
So Ted Roof decides to dial up some movement. He's not going to add an extra blitzer, but he tries to create movement. There's guys twisting inside all over the place. But this offensive line does a nice job staying home, giving Dak Prescott a clean pocket to throw into. A wide open Lewis outside. You move the sticks.
Quick pitch to Lewis on the outside, and he's got the first down, and now Mississippi State moving.
He's got to touch the ball a lot, Brent. He's their most dynamic player outside, whether it's conventional catching passes downfield, jet sweeps, reverses, lining up in the backfield. Get Lewis touches.
A lot of movement. So the flags come flying that time.
The one difference so far, Mississippi State looks like they're playing faster tempo.
False start. Multiple players on the offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Some of them playing too fast.
Yeah, a little bit too fast. You're right. They really kind of picked that up here early in the second half. Foot on the gas, trying to get Georgia Tech's defense back on their heels, trying to tire them out a little bit.
Georgia Tech has a defensive lineman number 96 who's down there in the pits. Didn't make the stop, but I want to mention Adam Gotsis. I've had a lot of Australian kickers this year around the SEC. Number 96, Gotsis, is the first Australian defensive lineman I've had. They call it gridiron. And he couldn't quite make the stop, but there is a penalty flag. Holding's going to be the call.
Holding, offense, number 63, 10-yard penalty, second down.
And that's Dylan Day, who was right down there in the middle of the trenches where Gotsis is.
Yeah, he's blocking Gotsis head up. You're right, Brent. And to your point, Gotsis, we talked about this D-line being kind of undersized. He's right here. He's going to be working against Day, the center, and that's where the penalty is going to happen. But Gotsis is really the only guy that kind of looks the part. You know, he's 6'5", he's 280 pounds, extremely athletic for a big guy, plays with a great motor. We talked about them needing to find ways to get pressure on Prescott. Gotsis is a guy that has to be big here in the second half.
On second and 21, dropped, and now it is third and 21. Lewis could not hang on. One final note about Gotsis before we let the folks just watch it. When Paul Johnson was an assistant coach at Hawaii, he coached the young man who became Gotsis' coach down in Australia. And so the former player called Paul up and said, I've got somebody who I think can play for you. And they looked at tape, and here he is, third down and 21 in a foot race. And now it is fourth and 21. Very good defense the last couple of plays, yeah, Jesse.
Keyshawn Freeman's a freshman All-American. He is their best pass rusher. He's a true freshman only, but again, movement, he starts here. There's going to be a twist inside, and that's where the pressure is going to come from Georgia Tech. Great athlete, forces Dak Prescott finally to move, and there's an example of the pass rush that Paul Johnson was wanting to see. Kind of in that no man's land again. Mississippi State is too long for a field goal, so they're lining up to go for it. This is fourth in California. You got to wonder if Dak Prescott, if they got a quick kick or something in their back pocket, he could punt this football. try and pin Georgia Tech deep.
The clock will start on the snap.
Gonna try to get it. Fires. Breaks a tackle. Wilson, no first down. Georgia Tech football.
Well, it basically ends up being a punt. That's better than a touchback because Georgia Tech's gonna take over inside their own 20-yard line. Dan Mullen saying, hey man, you got a comeback route over there that's not the right depth. If you want to look somewhere else, and Georgia Tech retakes possession.
We'll be right back. 28-20, Georgia Tech.
This is for the national championship for Nebraska.
So many moments that we all remember from the Orange Bowl through the years, now the Capital One Orange Bowl. Some of those scenes from the original Orange Bowl down in Miami, probably more great football games there than any old stadium in America. Who'll ever forget Joe Namath in Super Bowl III down there? It was all the great bowl classics that you saw. Here we go, first down and 10 now for Georgia Tech. This has been a good game also. They may be remembering this one. And it is Days who had that long touchdown run in his previous carry. Picks up 9 yards here, Jesse, on first down.
The guy becoming a weapon for Georgia Tech in the second half. I think you got to give this offensive line credit. Brent, they've been so good all season long getting push up front. They're led by an All-American at right guard, Mason, but they're extremely athletic. They're deep. They play 7 to 8 guys. And they've stayed healthy throughout the most of the season. They're a big reason why they've had success.
They come right back for the first down, and you were right, Jesse. They go right to the dive play, and it's open for Cynthia Days. And it is amazing when you take a look at this offense.
And it's a different way to do the dive. You're going to see how it affects McKinney. He's going to open up to his left, and number 50 runs left. And actually, the dive is coming back to the right side, so it's the same play, just a little bit of window dressing, and it's another really good example of Paul Johnson adjusting.
Basically, it's a 1-2-3 offense as Justin Thomas surveys the scene.
It is again.
They come right back with the same play. What a night Cynthia Days is having. Brown making the stop from Mississippi State.
But it's amazing to watch Paul Johnson coach because he doesn't have a script. He doesn't have a play sheet. He just watches the game from the sideline and calls the game accordingly. He can't watch tape with Mississippi State playing against his offense because they don't. So all he can do is anticipate what they're going to do. And then as the game unfolds, start making adjustments on the fly. He's become the master at that.
Second down and 3, and it is one Day's run after another.
Slow down. That's what happens if you can't stop the inside run. They're starting right tackle, number 75, Aaron Joe, limping off the field here right now. They're going to make a substitution. That's not an issue because they have a lot of depth. But if you can't stop the dive play, as Florida State found out in the ACC title game, the game will get interesting really, really quick.
Days has gone over 100 yards now, and they make a substitute with Zach Lasky checking in, and so it's the 1-2 punch coming Mississippi State's way.
Mississippi State just doesn't have a dive defender available, and McKinney's trying to get over to make the stop, but it's the A-back lined up outside that's normally blocking downfield on a safety or a corner. He's actually crashing inside and getting a chip up on the middle linebacker that's creating that crease.
Corey Dennis is one of the wide receivers. He's down at the bottom of your screen right now. Special teams guy, and pretty good blocker, and number 16. That's a young man who's going to have a job right after he gets married. That's right. He's engaged to Nikki Meyer, who is a volleyball player at Georgia Tech, and we understand she's not with us here tonight. They're engaged to be married, and yes, Urban Meyer has offered that young man a job as a graduate assistant. So there is Corey Dennis, and he'll have a father-in-law as a boss up in Ohio State. And look at this run by Thomas. Great speed, touchdown, his second of the night. Justin Thomas, they can't stop it, folks. 32 yards. Extra point. So after stopping Mississippi State on that fourth down, remember, it took Paul Johnson's offense only 7 plays to cover 81 yards. 3:05 off the clock. It's a 15-point Ramblin' Wreck lead.
The 2014 Capital One Orange Bowl is brought to you by the Venture Card from Capital One. Earn unlimited double miles with no blackout dates. Nissan, premier partner of the Heisman Trophy. Northwestern Mutual, proud official partner of the College Football Playoff. And Taco Bell, bringing you the first ever student section at the College Football Playoff. Live Mas.
Hey fans, be on the lookout for the Taco Bell student section, where Taco Bell at the College Football Playoff has provided 1,000 student tickets free of charge for the semifinals and championship game. Georgia Tech fans loving it. Traveled down from Atlanta, one of the great academic schools in the United States. And they are playing a little football here. Fielded by Johnson. Penalty flag.
During the return, holding on the return team, number 28, 10-yard penalty, first down.
Going back and taking a look at that last touchdown, it's another adjustment by Paul Johnson. We're used to seeing the A-back, B.J. Bostic, run out here on an option. This time, he cuts up field and blocks Ryan Brown at the defensive end spot. That allows Justin Thomas to get outside on the quarterback keep. You see Brown's got the quarterback. He gets chipped. Just a piece of him is taken. And a missed tackle by Will Redmond outside springs Thomas free. The tackling by Mississippi State here in the second half has just been awful.
Play action with Josh Robinson. Caught at the 31-yard line by Fred Ross, who's having a big night here.
Yeah, he's a guy that really kind of had a bit of a breakout season this year. You can line him up in the slot, line him up outside. He runs good routes. He's got hands. You know, this offense doesn't have an Amari Cooper or a Kevin White from West Virginia, but they got a lot of different guys that can make plays, and they spread the ball around.
Leading receiver with 64 yards. And he comes back to him. First down. Golden with the play defensively. Mississippi State moving the ball in the air.
And I think Dak Prescott needs to take over. You know, Dan Mullen, coach Tim Tebow, who also wore 15. And I think Prescott's got a little bit of Tebow in him with respect to the it factor and leadership, wanting the ball in his hands when the game's on the line. He's got to play well here.
Good pitch back outside. That's Morrow. Morrow has been active receiver here tonight.
Georgia Tech defender down. It looks from here like it might be their cornerback, DJ White, number 28. And if that's a fact, and he's their best cover corner, isolated one-on-one outside in Mississippi State, throwing the football as often as they are. He's not a guy that Georgia Tech can afford to miss.
Keep it up, So we'll take a break. Still 7:08 left in the third quarter. Georgia Tech enjoying a 2-touchdown lead. Aerial coverage provided by Goodyear. Whether you're going for it from a few yards out or from miles away, go with a tire with superior performance. Goodyear, more driven. 35-20 here in the third quarter. And there are some holes in that secondary right now. White is on his feet, but not playing. Isaiah Johnson is out. So we've got freshman Steph Durham is back there. Golden, of course, is a ringleader. Lynn Griffin is also in that secondary. So that's two starters who are out. If there was ever a time where Prescott is going to go to work. And here comes Prescott. Fumble! Georgia Tech recovers on the turnover. Jamal Golden, the hard-hitting safety, recovers it. I should say that he came up and punched the ball out.
Yeah, he beat a block by the tight end, Malcolm Johnson. Watch him right here. There's a block attempted right there by Malcolm Johnson at tight end. He's going to whiff on the block, gets outside, makes the stop, and there's number 41, Rod Rook Chungon, jumping on the football. The second takeaway of the game for Georgia Tech, and as we know, we talked about earlier, these are critical to the team's success.
So Golden, one of the two starters on the field, delivers with a big hit, and Days is back on, and he blasts his way to the 45-yard line on first down. All right. This is a pretty, as we look over there at that sideline with Robinson shaking up on the play, this is a pretty desperate drive for the Mississippi State defense.
Yeah, Mississippi State, they got to find a way to readjust to this dive play now. The A-backs, the guys that line up on the outside, they're now running right at middle linebacker Bernard McKinney. Here, getting a block inside on the inside, and that's what's causing the problem.
There's play action. Thomas with that great speed, and it is incomplete. He had a man open, and that was Days downfield as a target.
But in the big picture, Brent, you know, Mississippi State's been gashed. There's a myth that Paul Johnson's spread option offense doesn't create explosive plays. Yet tonight, they've got two passes, one of 41 yards, one of 39. They've got runs of 23, 69, and 32. You don't score 37 points a game going 3 yards in a cloud of dust every snap. It is a myth. This offense is explosive. And Mississippi State's found out the hard way tonight.
422 yards. And still tacking on more with that first down run.
And what a push up front by Georgia Tech's offensive line. Running behind their All-American right guard, Shaquille Mason. He's tremendous at drive blocking. He's athletic and he can pull. You're going to see number 70 right here. Pulling outside, getting extra bodies, getting into the second level. That's a good idea. This offensive line, probably better than most that Paul Johnson's had since he's been at Georgia Tech. They might be the best.
Freddie Burton, he's the anchor. He's out of Statesboro, Georgia. Daddy was a good player at North Carolina State, and here they are coming to the outside with Perkins.
Well, everything right now is working for Georgia Tech, and their A-backs are doing an unbelievable job blocking. We've seen them go get McKinney at middle linebacker on dive plays. Watch this player right here get outside on the perimeter of the field. That's number 3, Dennis Andrews. He's going to get a piece of a defender that's love outside. That creates the gap for 21 Perkins, and everything, all three phases of the option right now for Georgia Tech going to work.
Just banging right straight ahead into the red zone, taking time off the clock, just pounding the middle of this Mississippi State defense.
They wear you down. This is so unlike spread offenses that play up tempo and try to score quick. Georgia Tech's fine with scoring slowly, keeping the football, not giving it back. Your defense plays a lot of snaps, and right now this defense looks tired. Guys got their hands on their hips as they're going backwards. They need a turnover. They need something critical to happen.
Thomas keeps it, headed in zone. Three touchdowns for the Georgia Tech quarterback. Point.
Going back and taking a look at this touchdown, we talked about the A-back and how they're becoming involved in the blocking scheme. Here's a great example. Watch B.J. Bostic right here. He's going to peel around. Matt Wells is going to meet him. The block's going to get made, and that springs Justin Thomas right up the middle. Early in the game, they were going triple option. It was the A-backs that were carrying the football. They've made a bigger impact in this game blocking. That is textbook. Justin Thomas goes untouched. You're seeing why this offense is the highest scoring offense in the ACC.
And suddenly, ladies and gentlemen, the SEC is reeling. Look at this here tonight.
That's incredible. So many different ways they can beat you. Quarterback, the dive, the pitch man, they got bootlegs. They line up in very similar formations all game long, but it's a pretty extensive playbook with respect to the volume of running plays they have. And Dan Mullen, without his defensive coordinator, Jeff Collins, as good as they were throughout the course of the regular season, I've never seen an offense like this. Yeah, they had the extra time, they had a lot of looks, but it's not paying off right now.
From the goal line is Johnson. Well, short. He's down at the 14-yard line. Well, Bryce Petty leads the explosive Baylor Bears offense against Connor Cook and the Spartans, the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. Michigan State taking on number 5 Baylor New Year's Day at 12:30 Eastern on ESPN. Michigan State got the alert, and I dare say that Alabama may be paying a little attention to what happened to the team that beat them, Ole Miss, and the team that came within 5 points of them, Mississippi State. And Alabama will saddle it up tomorrow night against Ohio State in a semifinal. 42-20. Prescott slips a tackle, throws high, incomplete. Shumpert out of the backfield was the target.
Georgia Tech just looks fresh on defense, and that's a big advantage playing when you have an option offense, because your offense is on the field so long. They possess the ball 34 minutes every game. Every time Georgia Tech defensively takes the field, more often than not, they're fresh. And we talked about how they have tremendous speed. That's showing up right now for defensive coordinator Ted Roof.
He was in the front row in the middle with his glasses. Shumpert, the ball carrier that time, barges for the first down. And of course, especially bad day for the state of Mississippi if Mississippi State can't rally.
What happened to the defense?
Look at this, 84-23 through 6+ quarters. The state of Mississippi has been outscored. They were the center of the college football universe.
Great defense all year long.
Prescott barges out to the 35-yard line, and Davis making the stop. And again, Ted Roof is doing it with substitutes in that secondary.
Yeah, you know, I love the job Ted Roof has done since he took over last year as the defensive coordinator. You know, he simplified this defense. They're not crazy exotic. There's a Georgia Tech defender down on the ground right now.
He can ill afford to be losing another player.
Yeah, well,
that's Chungon, who recovered that fumble when Golden jarred the ball loose, and now now he's down on the field, because one thing they are not is deep. Now, when Roof agreed to come back, Jesse, it is very interesting, because it is tough. You ask him the question. You said, how difficult is it for a defensive coordinator when you've got an option offense and you're playing all these different kinds of offenses?
Yes,
and the coach had to agree to show him different looks in the spring.
Well, it's really tough. In the offseason, you can't get quality looks at more conventional offenses because the offense on your team runs the triple option. So ultimately what happens is starters, backup, and scout players run plays off of cards. They don't run it correctly. It's not always great looks. It's not really until in season that you get the proper looks, and that's still coming from your scout team. So from the jump in the offseason, this defense is at a disadvantage, but you got to give Ted Roof credit. I mean, he's got guys going down right now. Since he took over, they've become more vanilla. He lets his guys line up and play fast. They're not crazy exotic with blitzes all over the yard and crazy coverages. They play bend, don't break. They keep the football in front of them. They're opportunistic. They create turnovers. And tonight, I think they're playing lights out.
Oh, they really are. This is just an outstanding performance for Georgia Tech. ACC has had a heck of a season. They've got one team still standing, Florida State. And Georgia Tech with a big lead, and Shumpert stays on the field, picking up the first down.
Tell you what, the other thing this option offense does is put so much pressure on the opposing team's offense, because they don't know how many possessions they're going to get. They feel like they need to do something, and they have to score every time they get it. And at times, I think you can press.
Coming with Shumpert, and this will be second down. And the other thing working in Paul, I want to say something about Paul Johnson, though, and his players. If you draw a big circle around Atlanta, Georgia, I mean a big, big circle, there's a lot of good, smart football players that Paul Johnson can recruit. That's one advantage he has. He made it pay off at the United States Naval Academy, and he's done the same thing at Georgia Tech. Pass is complete, and diving was Wilson, and he's a little bit short of the first down marker. So we have 60 seconds left in 2014.
60 minutes.
I should say.
I'm popping the champagne.
I was looking for a glass.
Getting your Dom P from under the table there.
Get it
off the ice.
I apologize. Every now and then.
You got me.
I go
for it. You know what I mean? Hey.
Must be the age.
Get me all fired up over here.
First down with 10. Prescott stands tall. First down at the 34-yard line. Lewis again.
Well, there's a nice catch by Lewis. We've seen him drop a few. Him and his quarterback haven't quite been on the same page all game long. And small window over the middle of the field, vertically downfield. That's a nice job by Jamie Lewis making the catch.
Play action to Shumpert. Wilson again. Another first down and close to the red zone. And this is another one of those crisp drives.
It sure is, and they're playing with really good tempo. But here's a one-on-one opportunity. Georgia Tech blitzes. They don't do it very often, and it leaves a 6'5" receiver one-on-one with a true freshman backup corner. It's a good idea of where Dak Prescott goes with the ball.
The injury is taking a toll on that secondary. Mississippi State certainly taking advantage. Golden is the number one veteran, but we see that Isaiah Johnson, number one, has come back on the field.
Yeah, that's great news for them, being a leader in that secondary and a guy that's played a lot of snaps. He can help these young guys get lined up. And on Mississippi State, we're seeing the sense of urgency go away. The tempo's picked up. They understand now, down 22 points, they need to get in as many snaps as they can.
Lance Austin, a freshman linebacker, is on the field. Comes a reverse. Lewis. He's got good speed. And that was Johnson over on him. But it looked like he stepped out and picked up the first down just shy of the 10-yard line.
One advantage of having a 230-pound quarterback is he can match up one-on-one with a defensive lineman. And Patrick Gamble, that weighs 286 pounds. Look at 15 right here. Just kind of wall him off. It's not a pancake block by any stretch, but he gives Lewis an opportunity. We talked about him needing to get touches. There's a creative way to get number four the ball.
Obviously a sense of urgency now. Final half minute of the third quarter. Here comes Robinson back on the field. He battles his way close to the 5-yard line. And that was the end of the third quarter, I believe, that whistle.
The third quarter.
So they will change ends of the field right now. And in the third quarter, Georgia Tech outscored Mississippi State 21-0. And they lead it by 22, headed into the money quarter. Well, with Maria Taylor and Jesse Palmer alongside, I'm Brett Musburger as we welcome you back to the Capital One Orange Bowl and the fourth quarter, 42-20. Georgia Tech of the ACC leading Mississippi State of the SEC West. Second down, Prescott gonna take off. It's closed, throws, juggle, touchdown, Wilson.
What a play by Dak Prescott. You avoid the rush, buy more time, and extend the play with your legs. And at this point right here, putting the football where only his player can make the catch, right over top of the outstretched hands by that true freshman corner, Steph Durham. Look at Bear Wilson here. Looks like he juggled it.
He did juggle it
originally, and I don't know.
He did juggle it.
He's got possession
now.
Right,
he's got
now
possession.
That foot's
in the left
down.
Foot's
That's going to be a touchdown. Yeah. But a nice answer by Mississippi State early here in the fourth quarter. And they're going to have to continue that kind of efficiency, and at some point to get back in this game, Brent, they need to make a stop on D.
Sobiesk. Would you consider an onside kick this early?
No, not yet. But it's up, you can cut it a little bit later if your defense continues having problems tackling, continues having problems stopping the dive play. That's been an issue.
Wilson hangs on for the score. Prescott, two touchdowns and one interception here tonight. 342 yards.
Chances, but only one champion. The college football playoff on ESPN. Hallelujah.
Still 14:53 left before we hit Hallelujah. New year in our two semifinals. Georgia Tech upsetting Mississippi State 42-27. There it is, the onside kick. And Georgia Tech in a battle for it down there. Mississippi State thinks they've pulled it away. Let's see what the officials decide here. And they have saved it. The one thing that you think about with an onside kick this early in a game is the Georgia Tech time-killing offense.
No doubt about it. And they don't give the football back. You're not going to get many more chances. I would have thought Dan Mullen would have waited a little bit longer, but deciding to just be proactive, see if he can catch him off guard. And it's number 81, Ricky June, who's a wide receiver with good hands. He's up front. That ball actually ricochets off his right leg, then his left. He's able to just fall on top of it, giving them possession on Mississippi State's side of the field.
Now they come back with Zach Lasky. There's the B back.
Brett, that's the same dive play they've been running over and over here again in the second half, and Mississippi State has not been able to adjust to it. The A back to the side of the dive is kicking inside, getting the block on the middle linebacker McKinney. They're able to pull the right guard Shaquille Mason outside, and they're just taking away chunks of yardage.
Coming right back for a first down.
Early in the game, A-backs were carrying the football. Later in the game, they're the ones making the blocks. Check out here, number 31, Deion Hill, getting a block on McKinney. That sets the edge. You see Mason pulling. There's a big dive play. Later on, you got the quarterback keeping it. They fake the dive. You got Hill again going inside, kicking out a linebacker. And here you got B.J. Bostic coming up to get Wells in the hole. And just nobody home on the quarterback. These A-backs, they're multifaceted. They have to be able to carry the football. They got to be able to catch the football. They got to be able to block.
Coming back with Lasky again. You had a very perfect example of a cut block that time by the when you went through that replay. And it's interesting how I think Georgia Tech gets in other players, the opponent's heads, with all the talk about that. And it was a legal block, but they've become so kind of obsessed with it that they forget how to play sometimes, the linebackers against this offense. Lasky to the five. It's first and goal. Georgia Tech is not being denied. Good field position after the onside kick failed.
And that was just a straight dive where the offensive guard got up into the second level and made a block on the linebacker. They've done a really good job mixing up the way they're blocking these different schemes. And they've got Mississippi State completely on their heels.
508 yards of offense, 383 rushing yards already. Lasky that time is stopped in the hole, and he is pushed back by Richie Brown, a sophomore. Now, everyone expects McKinney to announce, along with Robinson, that he's going to go to the NFL. Jesse talked about it in the first half, that he could be a first or a second round player.
Well, yeah, you just can't coach his type of athleticism at 6'5", 250, the way he runs and all the different sorts of things he can do. You see
McKinney
him
out right now watching.
On the field.
Days is back. Justin Thomas has scored three times and timeout.
Timeout.
So Georgia Tech will burn a timeout. 12 minutes away from a big Capital One Orange Bowl victory.
The 2014 Capital One Orange Bowl is brought to you by the Quicksilver Card from Capital One. Earn unlimited 1.5% cash back every purchase, every day. Honda, start something special. Coca-Cola Zero. Zero means it's game day. And AT&T, presenting sponsor of the College Football Playoff National Championship Game.
Big Orange is on its way. 43 minutes to the new year. That's downtown Hotel Air Continental, designed by the man known as Mr. Neon, Steve Trevor. You're headed down that direction, aren't you?
I've been known to wander in that.
You won't wind up on South Beach.
No, right? I've never heard of it. What happens in South Beach?
Second down and goal for Georgia Tech. Thomas throws it away.
Smart. Nothing there downfield. You don't have to risk forcing the football. Just throw it away. You know, this is usually an area of the field they like to run behind their big right guard, Shaquille Mason, an All-American. number 70 with the push they've been able to get. I think Paul Johnson trying to catch Mississippi State by surprise on that last play. With the way they've been running it, Brent, especially the way they've been running it inside, I wouldn't be shocked if they went ahead and just ran a dive play, a simple dive play right here with the new blocking scheme.
Which is exactly what they do. Touchdown, Georgia Tech. Sinjin Days. Good call, Jesse.
Why stop if they can't stop you? We talked about this being the bread and butter in Paul Johnson's spread option attack. It's phase one. If you can't stop it, you got no shot. They've run it a lot of different ways. Tonight has just been a clinical, it's been a textbook, surgical precision by Paul Johnson and his adjustments from the start of the game to the end. This offense looking every bit as advertised.
Three touchdowns for Sinjin Days and three touchdowns for quarterback Justin Thomas. An unstoppable attack is unleashed on the SEC. Aerial coverage provided by Goodyear. Whether you're going for it from a few yards out or a few miles away, go with a tire with superior performance. Goodyear, more driven. Dancing time. It's been that kind of a night for the Ramblin' Wreck. You know, Paul Johnson has led his teams to either the FCS playoffs or an FBS bowl game in 17 of his 18 years as a college football head coach. The only season that a Johnson-led team did not make the postseason, 2002, his first at the United States Naval Academy. So as the seconds tick away here on 2014, coming up after this game, stay tuned for the presentation of the championship trophy and the Capital One MVP trophy. And the voters are going to have themselves a little bit of a difficult time. Justin Thomas, the quarterback, serious candidate with three touchdowns. Sinjin Days, he also has banged in for three touchdowns in this game. He's rushed for 149 yards tonight. Just a spectacular performance by Georgia Tech here tonight. Prescott eludes the pressure, fires wide open. Morrow, man, he's across the 40-yard line.
Last two pass plays Mississippi State has had, Dak Prescott has extended the play with his legs. He's found a big throw down the field. Mississippi State not quitting, down 22 points again. He's holding on for dear life.
Prescott's thrown for 377 yards. The handoff to Robinson as he brings down the curtain on his career at Mississippi State. Robinson announcing earlier today as Dak Prescott has put up a career high now with the performance here tonight. Always passing yards can be so misleading as to who wins or loses a football game. Because you're forced, when you're behind in a football game, you're just forced to keep winging the ball downfield.
No doubt about it, but he's had a phenomenal year. And he has a choice, still has a choice coming up on whether to leave for the NFL draft early. Now, he told us that he was going to come back next year. And I think that's the right move for him, Brent. I think he can still improve as a passer. He can increase his accuracy, be better in anticipation. He's got an opportunity. He's got an opportunity to be the number one quarterback taken next year, and that's serious money. I think he's doing the right thing if he does come back.
On third and eight, in underneath to Wilson. Wilson's got a first down and more. He's down around the 20-yard line. 11 minutes left for the Bulldogs. And Jesse, you said something that doesn't seem to be any quit.
No, not at all. Pedal to the metal, as always, on offense.
And we got a, now this is golden, is down.
Wow.
Almost everybody in that secondary at one time or another has been down.
You know, it's been a very physical game. I think
again, Georgia Tech understood that coming into tonight. They knew that they were going to have to stop the run and be physical. You go back and the games Georgia Tech lost this year, whether it was against Duke or North Carolina or Florida State, they suffered because they gave up rushing yards. That hasn't really been the case tonight. These guys have fought hard all season long, been opportunistic, creating turnovers. They were able to do that again tonight. When backups have gone in the game, they've still played pretty well. Just overall, I know they've given up 27 points, but considering all those different factors, got to be impressed with Ted Ruka, defensive coordinator, and his side of the football. It's been a complete dominant game for Georgia Tech.
Prescott, you can see how strong he is. First down and goal. Phenomenal running quarterback. Here tonight,
I gotta think
he has rushed 13 times. Now they've kept him under control. He has scored a touchdown. There's that fade knocked away from Wilson that time by White, who's back on the field. So as Golden comes off, White is able to come back on.
Yeah, you know, he got hurt a little bit earlier in the game, but he's their best man-to-man cover guy. Great hips, ball skills. Tech fans will remember him. He had the interception in overtime to seal the win against Georgia. Look at that's just perfect. In the air, locating the football. No contact with the receiver. They've been so good on the perimeter, I think, in this game defensively.
Now it's third and goal. Clock winding down to the 10-minute mark. 33 minutes to 2015. On the move, deflected, and suddenly it's fourth and goal. That was a terrific play by someone we haven't talked about, and that's Neely, number 54. He's one of the ringleaders of this defense, an outstanding football player.
Quayshawn Neely, he's known as a takeaway titan. He's been responsible for 6 takeaways on the season. Talk about how opportunistic this defense has been, a big reason why. Number 54. You got man-to-man across the board. That could be an opportunity for a big, tall receiver right here in the slot if there's a jump ball chance.
Looking in that direction. Backside pressure. Fires. Incomplete. Look who had coverage. Neely.
Better pressure in the second half by Georgia Tech. Whether they blitzed or whether they stayed vanilla, this time it's going to come right off the side here. The 41, Rook Chungon gets the pressure on Prescott. He's forced to throw the football back across his body. It's hard to do. It's a low throw. Still, on that play, Josh Robinson had a chance to make the play, and he's a running back that has extremely good hands. That obviously a difficult catch, and Georgia Tech takes possession back.
Hand it off to Days, who's back on the field.
We've seen a lot of statement games in the bowl season. We saw one earlier today, obviously by TCU, but what about this for Georgia Tech? Remember all the talk coming in tonight? Well, you're 1-5 in bowl games. The spread option offense is a disadvantage when you play good defenses, when they have more time to prepare for you. They have 390 rushing yards tonight. This is as good as Paul Johnson's offense has ever looked in the postseason that I can remember.
Last game. Thomas keeps it and he's down, and this will bring up a third down. Jefferson making the stop. You know, offsetting that a little bit, and I don't want to overplay this, but is the fact that Jeff Collins, who these defensive players of Mississippi State really like, has left to become the defensive coordinator at Florida. Somewhat of a lateral move, and Townsend A youngster forced into the position of calling plays here tonight. An outstanding young coach for Coach Mullen. And I had to bring the safety coach down out of the press box to help out down there. And look at this. Thomas out to the 31-yard line. And so the sands of time running out here on Mississippi State, a team that flourished in the middle of the state, flourished all the way to Tuscaloosa.
Well, Brandon, I do think it's a good point you bring up, not having Jeff Collins in this game, and that obviously maybe had been a distraction and a disadvantage for Mississippi State defensively. But, you know, continuity on defense from a coaching staff standpoint is something they've struggled with since Dan Mullen's taken over.
Thomas keeping it himself.
With Jeff Collins going to Florida next year, they're now going to have their fifth different defensive coordinator in Dan Mullen's seventh year as head coach at Mississippi State. It's hard to maximize player development when you don't have the same continuity in scheme or philosophy. You know, it's important that players are hearing the same voice year in and year out. Now, the scheme hasn't changed drastically under Dan Mullen, no matter who they've had. And for the most part, they've played good defense, but it is a problem that I think needs to be fixed. You've got to start having more continuity from the staff standpoint on that side of the ball moving forward.
Second down and five. And they give it to 37 Lasky, and not the only defensive coordinator on the board. Another buddy of ours, John Chavis, left LSU, and he'll go to Texas A&M and join Kevin Sumlin's staff.
It's the only conference I can think of where coaches make lateral moves to other teams. We talked about Jeff Collins. Took the same job over at Florida. Chavis leaves LSU, goes to Texas A&M. Will Muschamp gets fired as a head coach at Florida and just skips across the pond into the other division. Signs up with Auburn. Now he's the highest paid assistant in college football. It's
Randy Shannon, former head coach of Miami, has also signed on with that Florida staff, and he's an outstanding recruiter down in this part of Florida, which is what Jim McElwain has to put together up in Gainesville. But you know, you think about this as you watch Georgia Tech. There's a couple other schools out there that I've always wondered why they didn't copy this and go to. One of them happens to be in the SEC, and that's Vanderbilt. Same kind of a school, a lot of good athletes. If you draw that big circle around there.
Look at that number, 425 rushing yards, an Orange Bowl record.
Oh, it's amazing.
I mean, if anybody out there, high school, peewee, anybody is coaching option football, put this game on the reel.
And then keep in mind that Dan Mullen and Urban Meyer, as there's a penalty fight, Urban Meyer and Dan Mullen, they actually went to Paul Johnson to get a few wrinkles on the read option attack that they run, because nobody seems to know it any better. I mean, a lot of this is read
personal
option,
foul.
And then they just add
Chop
stuff
block.
To it.
Numbers 58 and 71 on the offense. 15-yard penalty. Repeat second
and,
down.
Speaking of Urban, he's yeah, he'll be busy tomorrow against Alabama and Nick Saban, Urban Meyer, two good buddies, and then of course the granddaddy of them all, Rose Bowl, the Oregon Ducks, Florida State. What do you make of the two Heisman Trophy quarterbacks?
It's must-watch television. But I'll tell you what, interestingly, it's the first time in Jameis Winston's career in college he's not the best quarterback on the field. The way Marcus Mariota has played this year, I cannot wait to watch that game, and I expect Winston to be lights out.
I thought you were going to tell me it's the first time he's ever been an underdog, which also happens to be the case.
You would know it.
Hill, as a matter of fact, when that came out about 9 points, I said, they got to know something I don't.
Yeah.
Florida State's still a pretty good football team. I know they had to dig in and come from behind a few times this year. But go down and ask these fellows from Georgia Tech what they thought of Jameis Winston and the Noles. It's going to be a heck of a game.
Now get back to this option offense for Georgia Tech real quick. You know, it's funny. It's a unique offense today. Decades ago, though, it was commonplace. But today it's become the ultimate equalizer. I don't think they're as good man-to-man on offense as a Florida State, Georgia, or Clemson. But they can win those games, or they can be at least competitive, because the scheme's the ultimate equalizer.
Clemson with a great bowl performance against Oklahoma for the ACC. Here's one of the stars of the Ramblin' Wreck, and Georgia Tech fans can look forward to Justin Thomas for the next couple of years. No question. He's been the ringleader of this offense tonight. You can't look past what Days And now he's
he's tough. I'll say that. I mean, you're talking about a guy that's 5'11", 190 pounds, and he takes a beating. He's taking shots when he's throwing the football. He's already run the football 14 times. But you can't get him rattled. We've seen that all season long. You watch him, the way he's finished games against Virginia Tech, Georgia, even Florida State in their final drive. This guy plays to the last whistle.
Rodwell. Moss on the 14. Looking for a hole. Just short of midfield that time. And guess who brought him down? Quayshawn Neely, their outstanding middle linebacker. Good job on a special team. And now for tonight's Capital One pivotal performance, and Jesse, it has to be quarterback Justin Thomas.
Yeah, Justin Thomas has been the ultimate dual threat quarterback, making plays with his arm deep down the field to Waller. We've seen him and his speed, flashes athleticism, making defenders miss, on his way to running for over 100 yards as well. I said it again, he's the best quarterback Paul Johnson has ever coached in Georgia Tech. He's the reason this has been a record-setting offense this year. He's a big reason why they're going to be Orange Bowl champions. They're going to be an 11-win team.
As we send it down, let's say Happy New Year to Maria. You've got more on Justin.
Well, Happy New Year, guys. And Justin Thomas, he's actually Paul Johnson's first ever sophomore to be named captain of a team. And DeAndre Smelter, the wide receiver, unable to play today due to injury, said this team rallies around Thomas. He's been another dimension to the team, and they believe they can win because he's been their starting quarterback all season.
And now that defense, led by Gotsis, the young man from Australia.
I talked again about just an improved pass rush, and obviously Mississippi State becoming one-dimensional has allowed these guys to pin their ears back. They're using movement up front. It's 97 Sean Green on the stunt that forces Dak Prescott to move up in the pocket, and there's Gotsis, a second-team All-ACC defensive tackle, cleaning it up.
Sean Green is injured on that play. He's the Georgia Tech player, and he's up now and walking off under his own power. So that's good to see. It's really been a team effort here.
Yeah, no doubt.
By Georgia Tech.
And a great way to stamp the season, Brent. You know, coming into this year under Paul Johnson, this team was 1-5 against Virginia Tech, 1-5 against Georgia, 1-5 against Miami. They beat all of them. To a 10-win regular season, to get to the Orange Bowl. Under Paul Johnson, Georgia Tech has finished first or second in the Coastal 6 of his 7 years. He was deserving of the 4-year extension they gave him through 2020. Every penny.
No doubt. Strike to Robert Johnson. And a reminder to stay tuned for the Ford post game right after this football game. And we just get word from down below that Justin Thomas is the MVP of this game. And incomplete for Fred Brown. Final 3 minutes here of the Capital One Orange Bowl. And your champions are going to be from the ACC.
Yeah, you know, it's such a great game. It's also a great week for all these players, the coaching staffs, the fans. The Orange Bowl year in, year out is one of the classiest bowl games both on and off the field. I know that because I played in it. At the end of the 1998 season, we played against Donovan McNabb at Syracuse. Dan Mullen, actually, was on their coaching staff, but they do a phenomenal job. This just caps off what's been a great year and a great week here at the Orange Bowl.
Prescott keeps the drive alive with that fourth down pass to Malcolm Johnson.
Mississippi State, you know, isn't going to capitalize, isn't going to put the exclamation point on what's really still been a magical season. It's important not to lose sight of that. Playing in the SEC West, winning 10 games, three straight top 10 opponents, being number one for 5 straight weeks, nothing to gawk at.
And that is Morrow again, Joe Morrow to the 10-yard line. He's been a big target here tonight for Prescott. 91 yards.
All these guys coming back. Joe Morrow's coming back next year. Bear Wilson, Fred Ross. They got a lot of weapons in the perimeter of the field for Dak Prescott to throw to. Going to have a chance to be explosive next season.
Prescott fires in zone. Dive for touchdown, Wilson.
I think he just loved the fact that this team keeps fighting. I think that's an indictment on Darren Long and his coaching staff. Players don't quit. Dak Prescott doesn't quit. Bear Wilson, that's a perfect back shoulder throw. There is no defense for a perfect throw. And as well as DJ White, number 28's play it all game. And he's been unbelievable.
Wrapping that up as he hits the ground. Yeah, indeed, I agree with you, Jesse. That's a huge compliment to Coach Mullen and his staff. And they should have a good team next year, too.
Yeah, no, they will. They're going to lose three offensive linemen. They lose Jamie and Lewis, and we know now they lose Josh Robinson. I think the biggest question for them is going to be on defense. They lose seven starters there, and, of course, we don't know who the defensive coordinator is. There's a lot of talent. Dan Mullen told us he thinks next year's team might be more talented on the field than this year's. The one issue with that is there's a lot of teams in the SEC West that feel the exact same way. When you take a look at their schedule, there's going to be some hills and valleys. Non-conference, the toughest game is probably Louisiana Tech, which is the good news. They get Alabama, LSU, Ole Miss at home. That's good news. They do have to cross over into the SEC East and play on the road at Missouri, which is going to be tough. They got some tough road games in their own division at Auburn, at Texas A&M, at Arkansas. That's going to be a lot better. But with Dak Prescott back, he's a guy that's going to be a Heisman candidate. People will talk about him early in the season. He'll give them a chance. Be fun to watch.
Here comes the second onside kick. Trailing by 15, 2:20 to go. Wrapped up. Isaiah Johnson, the safety. Well, the NFL playoffs are coming up this weekend. First playoff game on ESPN. Cam Newton and the NFC South champion Panthers. They've won four straight, and now they face Patrick Peterson, one of the most dominant defenses of the game. It's win or go home now for two NFC teams to prove they belong. Wild card round. Cardinals, Panthers. And, of course, the big issue for the Cardinals, as it has been for the last month, is who in the world is going to be their quarterback. They'll make a decision later this week to see who's healthy and who isn't. First down and 10. Panthers in a actually the Panthers playoff started last week. They went into Atlanta and won that game in impressive fashion for Cam Newton. And, the Steelers, by beating the Bengals, they'll host a game. Dallas Cowboys will host the Detroit Lions. And of course, the big story this week was Ndamukong Suh, because that foot was so numb he just didn't know that he was stepping backwards all over the quarterback of the Green Bay Packers. I like Ndamukong Suh, but sometimes you just left kind of shaking your head, aren't you? They're trying to work on this clock now as they run with their fullback, and they've got a minute 28 to kill, and the ceremonial bath for Coach Paul Johnson.
Hasn't had a lot of these in the postseason.
No,
his second
really
bowl win since he's been at Georgia Tech.
See, those rascals are trying to slip up behind him.
That's right. Well, there's a strategy to that. there's got to be the guy that distracts him, that gets out in front. Normally, it's a captain. Normally, it's someone that he certainly respects. Otherwise, you know, why is he talking to him? And the key is the flavor. You got the lemon lime, which is a good flavor to go with. That's a favorite of a lot of players. Orange is another one. You get the fruit punch in the red, maybe the lemon. But you see, you got some other guys. Now, the guys that do the actual bat themselves, generally it's safe if those are star players. But at this point, I think for all these guys, it's just been a tremendous night. This is he's going to hate it the second it hits. But he won't mind the dry cleaning bill, I promise you that.
Third down and three. I don't know how close he wears. It could be Washington. First down, banging ahead is Days.
Yeah.
organization. You'd think some engineers would be able to figure this out down there, wouldn't you?
No doubt about
it. These guys take calculus. Come on.
I think a lot of that's fear. Fear from the players. Not really sure. You know, who's going to do it? Are you going to do it? Am I going to do it? When do we do it? Can we do it when the game's still going on? Is he going to... Am I kicked off the team?
Days. And the clock ticks inside of a minute. We've got about 12 minutes, so they're going to wrap this up.
All right, here it comes. Players have finally picked up the bucket. Yeah, they got it.
They finally got it.
They need a shield guy.
There you go.
You got coaches going over and congratulating Paul Johnson now, but no players that are kind of...
Do I do it now?
Yeah, screening him, doing his work, yeah. Usually Bostic's over there talking to him now on the sideline. No distraction. He's got a security guard beside him.
This is a new experience.
Ooh, great,
you know what Paul
great,
said?
Great
get
camera.
This over with.
Oh, no, you see, it's terrible. That's just rookie stuff.
You got to come in.
Pushing.
Now they chased him. Okay. Great job by Paul Johnson and Georgia Tech all season long. Lost back-to-back games to Duke and North Carolina, regrouped, and had a November to remember. And they finish off 2014 by capturing the Capital One Orange Bowl in impressive fashion, 49-34. Setting up the stage there to present the championship trophy. And Maria Taylor is with Paul Johnson. Maria?
Coach, you almost escaped the Gatorade bath.
Yeah, I almost got away.
Your team was able to set an Orange Bowl rushing record here today and operated with precision. What allowed you to have so much success in the run game?
I thought Justin Thomas really played a great game. He made some guys miss, and we got our offensive line did a pretty good job coming off the ball. We blocked pretty good on the perimeter.
You talked about how important it is for your defense to remain opportunistic. That's exactly what happened today. How did they come up with those turnovers?
Well, we played pretty good in the red zone. Between the 20s, we gave up a ton of yardage, but when we got down there, we made them kick some field goals, and we got a couple turnovers, and that's all we needed.
Well, you get the victory in a very loud fashion. What kind of statement did Georgia Tech football make today?
Well, this is a good football team. I think we're a top 10 football team for sure, and I'm proud of these guys. And for at least a week or two, we don't have to hear about the SEC.
Congratulations, Coach.
Thanks.
452 rushing yards, 577 total yards. And the Ford postgame show is going to be coming up here in a little bit. But right now, we're going to send you to SportsCenter. Paul Johnson with the Gatorade bath. The Ramblin' Wreck. Big night here in South Florida. Right now, we're going to send you along to SportsCenter. We'll be back.